Although Millennium is one of the newer superpowers in the world of Blue Archive, its impact should not be underestimated. From the technological advancements of its students to the mysterious ruins just next door, Millennium's district is intricately tied to Kivotos' future, and the ethical struggle unfolding within its borders would become one of the most important moments in Kivotos' history. As always, I will be delving into extensive spoilers for the game. This particular video will include spoilers for the entirety of the Clockwork Flower Pavan, as well as Decagrammaton. If this is your first Lore Archive video, I might suggest checking out my Abydos video first, but if you're okay with spoilers and you still want to watch, please feel free to do so. Welcome to the newest volume of Lore Archive. As with all my Lore Archive videos, I have written this video to be less of a lecture and more of a story. This volume of Lore Archive will weave together the events unfolding at Millennium, as well as my interpretation of the events that occur. The events of this particular section take place alongside the Eden Treaty, and although they don't directly impact each other, they are both vital for the final arc of our story. Despite my best efforts, this video is still very long, so please don't feel like you have to tackle it in one go. I will be leaving lots of timestamps throughout the entire video, so you can find your place if you need to return to this later. With my preamble now out of the way, it's time for the newest addition to the Lore Archive Anthology. Within the office of Shale, Sensei was organizing their most recent pile of requests from the students of Kivotos. It had been some time since the teacher had awoken in the city, but they had slowly become accustomed to the push and pull of the city. As Sensei stapled several papers together, they reflected that Shale and the broader academy city had started to feel like home. But there were still too many unanswered questions to feel completely settled. Although Sensei had met some of the most powerful figures within Kivotos, there were notable absences from that list. In particular, the leadership of Seminar, the Student Council of Millennium, had only briefly interacted with the teacher before retreating back into their seclusive district borders. From what Arona had told Sensei, it sounded like Millennium was a newer player on the Kivotos political stage, but the school's ingenuity and dedication to science had launched them to stardom, and many of Millennium's technological inventions were used throughout the entire city. The district had a reputation for enrolling the brightest, most inventive students, but they were also infamous for their student council president, Tsukatsuki Ryo. Sensei had never met Seminar's president, Ryo, but the girl was said to be extremely intelligent and extremely paranoid. Although Ryo pursued rationality above all else, her paranoia about threats to Kivotos had led to her installing a massive surveillance network across the entire Millennium campus, allowing her to monitor anyone who passed through the district. Sensei had met plenty of paranoid authority figures within Kivotos, particularly after the General Council president had disappeared, But Ryo seemed to have taken this to a whole new level. The other members of Seminar, Hayase Yuka and Ushio Noa, had seemed friendly enough when Sensei had briefly met them, but the teacher hadn't seen them in quite a while, and Sensei wondered if now was the perfect time to check in with them and make sure that everything was all right. The teacher was startled from their thoughts by Arona, who had just received a new request at the chalet help desk. Pushing away their troubled thoughts, Sensei made their way over to the Shatim chest and listened to the request aloud. "This is an urgent request from Millennium. The Game Development Club is fighting for its survival. The Student Council has us cornered, and you're our only hope. Please, Hiro, save us." The teacher couldn't believe their good fortune. It might not be exactly what they had envisioned, but the message couldn't have arrived at a more perfect time. Aiding the Game Development Club would give Sensei the chance to finally investigate Millennium and determine the truth of the rumors they had been hearing. Unbeknownst to the teacher, they were about to set foot into one of the most hostile districts in the entire city, one plagued with deception, mystery, and long-buried secrets that were about to be exposed. Let me tell you the tale of how Kivotos's most advanced school unraveled under paranoia, and how a long-lost experiment, a distrustful absolutist, and a beloved hero sought to prove what it means to be alive. The Game Development Club might not have been known to Sensei, but they were infamous in the Millennium District for their chaotic and misguided projects. Constantly on the verge of being shut down, the members of the Game Development Club were well accustomed to taking desperate measures to ensure their own survival. Even if that meant raiding other clubs for materials or setting up a gambling parlor to raise funds for game development. Although they frequently earned the wrath of Seminar's treasurer Yuka, the game club's open disregard for Seminar's rules had gained them loyal allies within the district, many of which were even more willing to push back against Seminar's authority. In particular, the mischievous members of the hacking club Veritas had caused digital mayhem throughout Millennium, only managing to avoid reprimand due to the club's crucial role in keeping the school's servers up and running. However, Veritas and the Game Development Club's luck was beginning to run out. Seminar's Secretary Noah and Treasurer Yuka tried to be fair council members, but the Millennium Council funds were beginning to run dry, and all the damages from Veritas and the Game Development Club were starting to add up. Something had to be done to get these clubs in line, and so Seminar decided on a plan to stamp out the club's troublemaking once and for all. The first drastic order was to raid the Veritas clubroom, confiscating all the hackers' most impressive, but questionably legal, equipment, including the most powerful hacking tool in their arsenal, the Optimus Mirror System, which had been personally designed by the Veritas Club president, Akeboshi Himari, to break even the most secure encryption. Despite the protests of the Veritas members, all the confiscated equipment was taken away to the seminar contraband storage, where it was locked away from further use. The gaze of Seminar then turned to the Game Development Club and the guidelines for club formation. As it currently stood, clubs needed to have 4 active members and must produce 1 notable achievement every year. But despite their best efforts, the Game Development Club had not satisfied either of these requirements. Per Millennium's club guidelines, the Game Development Club had less than a month to find 1 other member and produce a notable game. And with how little time they had left, it would be nearly impossible to successfully meet this deadline. Without needing to lift a finger, Seminar had finally found the perfect way to disassemble the Game Development Club and prevent any more misuse of Seminar funds. With this ultimatum, the Game Development Club flew into a panic. The club's president, Hanaoka Yuzu, was petrified of losing the club room and being forced back to the dorms, where she would be crushed under the weight of her crippling social anxiety. The club's illustrator, Saiba Midori, was trying to keep a level head and find a logical solution to their problem. But the prospect of recruiting a new member and finishing an entire game in a month was daunting. The club's final member and scenario writer, Saiba Momoi, was the only one still maintaining a cheerful demeanor, declaring that they would overcome this challenge and emerge victorious against their seminar foes. Without another moment's hesitation, Momoi had written an urgent message to Shale asking for their help before flying off towards Veritas to gather whatever advice she could for solving their predicament. Midori and Yuzu did not share Momoi's optimism. By the time Sensei arrived at the Game Development Club, Yuzu had hidden away completely from sight in a cupboard nearby, and Midori's spirits were dampened by the impending deadline. Momoi, however, was ready to burst with excitement at the sight of the teacher, and without giving Sensei a chance to speak, the girl began detailing her grand plans to save the club from certain doom. For several months, the club had been unsuccessful in recruiting new members, but they could worry about that later. Veritas had scraped through Millennium's databases, rather brazenly, in search of something that could help the Game Development Club, and they had learned of a game development encyclopedia that could potentially save the club from disillusion. Created by a legendary Millennium game developer, this G-Bible encyclopedia was said to contain the secrets to creating a perfect game, but its location had been redacted from the school records. Momoi declared that their new mission was to find this G-Bible and then create the perfect game, which would be the exact achievement they needed to keep their club afloat. The location of this G-Bible was redacted, but there was exactly one location that fit that description: the nearby ruins of an ancient Kivotos district, which bordered Millennium nearby. The entire club was silent as Momoi finished talking. Her enthusiasm was commendable, but such a plan seemed completely absurd. Creating a perfect game? The whole thing was a little more than unbelievable. Truthfully, though, they didn't have many other options. And even if it was ridiculous to make a perfect game, the fact that such an infamous gaming encyclopedia was just next door made the remaining club members more receptive to Momoi's plan. As the other game development members agreed with Momoi's plan, that just left Sensei, who was trying to determine how dangerous this mission would really be. The teacher had become well acquainted with huge, sprawling ruins in the district of Abydos, but they had no idea what to expect from Millennium, and wandering around an abandoned district seemed like a great way to run into trouble. However, it seemed like the girls were determined to explore the ruins, whether Sensei joined them or not, and so the teacher decided it was best to go along with them in case they needed Shale's assistance. The club's president Yuzu was too nervous to venture outside with them, so as she stayed behind, that left Midori, Momoi, and Sensei to head out to the ruins nearby in search of this mysterious G-Bible. Despite all the time they had spent in Abydos, the teacher was still surprised by the sheer scale of this abandoned district at the edge of Millennium. Only a short walk from the pristine Millennium buildings lay a sprawling assortment of offices, factories, and research facilities, all of which were in various states of decay. Thick moss covered most of the stone surfaces, and giant cracks revealed the effects of erosion on the structures. According to Momoi, the General Student Council used to station soldiers here to keep curious students out. But ever since the General Council president had disappeared, those forces had been pulled out to protect the Sanctum Tower. This meant they wouldn't face any resistance as they searched for the G-Bible, but it also meant that whatever the Sanctum Tower was protecting here was now exposed, and Sensei was becoming increasingly uneasy at what that might entail. All of this was seeming like a tremendously bad idea, and the teacher opened their mouth to call off the entire operation, only to be silenced by Midori's worried hand, pointing to a series of soldiers marching nearby. It was immediately clear that these soldiers were not from the General Student Council. They were entirely robotic and sported a distinctive pattern that reminded Sensei of Bina, the robotic behemoth that plagued the Abydos desert. But they were quite far away from Abydos, so such a connection seemed unlikely. Seeing the impending danger, Momoi sprinted towards a building nearby, leaving Sensei and Midori only a second to groan before chasing after her. Midori and Momoi provided covering fire while they raced into the building, hurrying to safety before the robots could attack. However, the robots stopped just short of the building, looking almost apprehensive before retreating back to their patrol through the ruins. Wherever they currently were, it was a place that the robots dared not tread, and that was enough to make the teacher's skin crawl. intercom static crackled nearby, and the group quickly turned to where the sound had come from. An inhuman voice crackled through the air.
Saiba, Midori, Saiba, Momoi, unqualified, access denied.
Momoi and Midori froze as their names were spoken, confusion beginning to wash over their faces. Sensei hadn't seen a scan even be performed, and yet whatever this computerized voice was, it knew exactly what their names were and had deemed them unauthorized to be in this location. This situation was becoming more dangerous by the second. Sensei began thinking through scenarios for them to escape before being interrupted by the voices continued talking.
Sensei, qualified. You have permission to enter, Sensei.
The teacher had absolutely no idea what was going on. They had never been here before, at least not that they could remember, and yet this robotic voice had decided that they were qualified to be in this area. The intercom crackled once more with a quick addendum.
Saiba, Midori, Saiba, Momoi, students of Sensei. Access as companions granted. Bottom floor open.
Before anyone could say another word, the floor opened up beneath them and they tumbled down into the darkness below. It was a miracle that Sensei didn't break anything in their fall. They were bruised and battered, but the drop distance hadn't been as large as they had feared. The group awkwardly stood to their feet, trying to assess where they now were. At the center of the room, bright light spilled down from above, illuminating a circular platform that held a single computerized display and a chair, which seemed to be occupied. Sensei froze as the room came into focus. At the center of this illuminated room, there was a person. At first, Sensei feared she might be a corpse, as she did not have a halo or any clothing to speak of, but it almost seemed like she was in a deep slumber. Midori quickly noted that there were printed letters on the girl's body that read AL1S. With a growing realization, Sensei recognized that this girl was almost certainly robotic in nature, and that AL1S was her serial number. The teacher had met plenty of robotic citizens in Kivotos, but none of them had ever looked like the students to this extent. Feeling bad that the girl was completely unclothed, Midori started shuffling through her bag and pulled out a change of clothes. Her sister Momoi might have sold this as a quick day trip to the ruins, but Midori had long become accustomed to preparing for the worst and had packed a complete change of clothes just in case they had to camp overnight. Moving very carefully, Midori and Momoi lifted the girl out of her chair and helped her into Midori's spare clothes. Sensei leaned forward to try and get a better look at the girl now that she was off the podium, only to be startled by a sharp set of beeps resonating throughout the chamber. Contact with approved subject detected. Dormant state deactivated. Midori, Momoi, and Sensei staggered backwards, quickly realizing that the voice had not come from the intercom upstairs, but from the girl in front of them. Sensei's hunch had been correct. This girl was clearly an android of some sort, as her ice blue eyes were ringed like the lens of a camera, focusing in and out as she looked at them. Much to the teacher's surprise, they realized that the girl was now sporting a halo above her head. The teacher was positive that that had not been there before, but as soon as the girl opened her eyes, a soft green halo had suddenly materialized. Sensei cleared the lump in their throat, pushing down dread as they sought the next question to ask. Who are you? What is this place? Why was I granted access here? Answer not found. This is presumably the first occurrence of deep consciousness for this unit. Answers unknown. It wasn't exactly what Sensei had been hoping for, but it was still useful information. According to the android, this was the first time she had ever been activated, which meant she had been down in this isolated room at the bottom of a ruinous district for an unfathomable amount of time. This girl might be an android, but she had enough similarity to the students that a halo had activated when she awoke. If that was the case, they needed to get her out of here and try to determine what next steps to take. The teacher proposed bringing her to Shale, but Momoi and Midori volunteered to shelter her instead, as AL-1S was somewhat unsteady in her movements, and the long trip back to Shale might prove too difficult. Sensei agreed that the girls could shelter AL-1S overnight, while the teacher dug up whatever information they could on the ruins. Carefully making their way out of the basement, the group moved out of the building, with AL-1S following quietly alongside them. A brief crackle from the intercom sounded behind them, but it was barely audible as they passed by it. Keeping an eye out for the hostile robots, Sensei, Midori, Momoi, and AL-1S carefully made their way out of the ruins, leaving the mysterious intercom and the G Bible behind them. After multiple reassurances that Midori and Momoi could handle AL-1S, Sensei left the group to head back to Shale, where they were prepared to spend the entire night sifting through records to get more information on the ruins. Sensei headed out to the bus station and made the girls promise to stay out of trouble. Momoi cheerfully agreed, but it was Midori's firm reassurance that convinced Sensei to finally leave the girls on their own for the night. Sensei would be researching anything they could find about who this girl was, but in the meantime, they needed to do something to keep her safe and out of the prying eyes of Seminar. Momoi thought for a few seconds and then proclaimed that they should give the girl a proper name, since AL-1S would definitely set off some alarm bells if Seminar were to stop by. It wasn't a bad start, since AL-1S was an unusual name for a Kivotos student. Momoi proposed Aris, which would be a little more believable to a prying outsider. A soft smile spread across AL1S's face. Unit designation, Aris, confirmed. The newly named Aris said aloud. Was Aris happy to have been given a name? Midori's thoughts were interrupted by Momoi, who was excitedly detailing her next plan of action. Aris would need a place to stay while Sensei dug up information on her. And they needed 4 club members in order to preserve the game development club. They could disguise Aris as a Millennium student with the help of Veritas, and she could stay out of harm while Sensei figured out what their next steps would be. Midori was well accustomed to Momoi's harebrained plans, but this might be the most reckless one yet. They had only agreed to keep watch over Aris overnight, not house her indefinitely and pretend that she was a Millennium student. But as Midori looked over Aris again, remembering that soft smile the girl had had when she was acknowledged as a person with a name, Midori couldn't help but feel like Aris might enjoy being a student and could experience what it was like to live in Kivotos. Letting out a long, exhausted sigh, Midori agreed with Momoi's proposal, much to her exuberant sister's delight. Before the night was done, they would employ Veritas's help in registering Aris as a Millennium student, and they would get to work disguising her as a Kivotos resident. While Momoi sprinted off to Veritas to hack into Seminar and get Aris registered as a student, Midori worked on helping Aris become more comfortable with speaking. As things currently stood, everything that came out of Aris's mouth were short, robotic phrases that were difficult to understand, and this would immediately blow her cover. Midori had no idea what would happen if the other students, or even Seminar, suspected Aris of being an android and dreaded the thought of her being dragged off to a research lab somewhere. Midori's thoughts were interrupted when she noticed Aris looking through a game magazine on the floor. Opening the catalog to the pages marked with pink sticky tags. You don't have to look at that, Midori stammered. It's a little embarrassing, but that magazine has an article about a game that our club made. The game got a lot of bad reviews. It even won the worst game of the year. Recalling that event brought on an onslaught of bad memories. The game development club had always been ambitious, but their first game together had been a colossal flop, earning ridicule instead of accolades. The bad reviews had been so horrid that the club's president Yuzu had become even more reclusive, refusing to take any classes in person as she hid away from the public. Momoi and Midori had slowly been getting Yuzu to go outside for brief periods of time, but it was a difficult hurdle to cross after such a colossal failure. Taking a moment to think, Midori wondered if Aris might want to see the game for herself, which would certainly be an embarrassing sight, but if Aris was going to be a member of their club, then Midori couldn't shield her from this forever. Scrolling through the files on the club's PC, Midori pulled up the copy of Tales Saga Chronicle, the infamously terrible game that their club had made 6 months prior, and handed a controller to Aris. Gripping the controller in her hands, Aris looked at the monitor in anticipation. Midori's pulse began to race nervously, unsure of what Aris would make of their game, but accepted that it was time to get this over with. The game development club had to produce something in order to ensure their survival, and if they couldn't learn from their past failures, then they would never be able to move forward again. Aris leaned forward, her eyes widening as she focused on the screen and began to play Tales Saga Chronicle. The game was predictably terrible to play. Momoi had written scenarios that were unintuitive for players to solve, and Yuzu had made several of the encounters entirely too difficult to traverse. Midori's retro art style was a little outdated for most modern players, and the dialogue was all over the place, causing Aris to frequently pause in confusion to get clarification from Midori. However, despite the number of times that Aris had to restart the game, and the mounting frustration that the android girl was experiencing, Aris kept insisting that she'd try again. As Midori watched, Aris kept throwing herself through the difficult challenges, learning from her mistakes and getting better at each subsequent challenge, until 3 hours had passed and the final scene appeared on the screen. Aris was actively panting, her circuits in overdrive as she made her way through the entire game, and Midori was beginning to wonder if this had been a good idea. Maybe showing Tales Saga Chronicle to someone who had just gained sentience was the wrong way to go about this. But as Midori's thoughts began to spiral, Aris fixed her with a look of sheer joy. This was a game that you designed? The more I played, the more it felt like I was transported to a new world. It was like a dream. I don't want it to end. I need more. Aris's speech was definitely stilted, and she had adopted terminology that was very similar to the characters in the game, but for the first time, someone had truly, genuinely enjoyed playing the club's terrible game. Aris might be the exact type of person that the game development club had been looking for. Midori's thoughts were interrupted by the sliding of a cabinet door, and Midori realized that President Yuzu had emerged from hiding nearby. Gently moving her long orange hair out of her face, Yuzu hesitantly shuffled closer to Aris. Did you really like Tales Saga Chronicle? I've only heard positive things from Momoi and Midori. This is the first time that someone outside the club has liked it. I've always wanted to make a game that people would enjoy playing. Yuzu's eyes were filling with tears as she choked out the words. It took a long time for Yuzu to warm up to people, but Aris had managed to win her over with such genuine enthusiasm. As Midori took in the situation, she began to realize how fortunate they had been for finding Aris. You said that you wanted to play more, right? Your speech is already improving so much just from playing Tales Saga Chronicle. Why don't we walk you through all the classics? It took Veritas a little bit of time to carefully hack into Seminar But they were able to safely register Aris as a student and get an ID card printed. Momoi excitedly skipped back to the game development club, only to find Aris huddled at the computer, surrounded by a mountain of games. As Momoi entered the room, Midori groggily opened her eyes, and Aris excitedly turned her gaze away from the monitor. "You've finally opened your eyes," Aris said aloud. "Thank goodness. I was not sure you were ever going to wake up." "Aris," Momoi and Midori said excitedly. "You can speak normally now." Despite her video game-like speech and her unfamiliarity with certain concepts, Aris was already fitting in with the rest of the game development club, and all they had to do now was get her a proper weapon and she'd be able to blend in as a Millennium student. After bidding Yuzu goodbye, the rest of the game development club headed out to procure a weapon for their new club member. Despite how early in the morning it was, Millennium's engineering club was already hard at work in their storehouse. The head of the engineering meisters, Shiraishi Utaha, greeted the game development club with a smile. After Momoi glazed over how they'd found a fourth member for their club, she asked if Utaha had anything lying around that Aris could use. At the mention of weapons, Nekozuka Hibiki beckoned the club over to their corner of the storehouse, where all the prototype weapons were being stored. According to Hibiki, Aris would probably be best suited with a pistol, and they had just the model for her to test out, which was even equipped with Bluetooth and NFC technology in case Aris wanted to use it like a credit card. However, Aris had become distracted by a prototype leaning against the wall nearby, and engineering club member Toyomi Kotori immediately took notice. "You have a good eye, customer. That prototype was made using 70% of our club's budget and is our most ambitious project yet. A railgun fit for an intergalactic battleship." Midori knew that the engineering club was obsessed with intergalactic travel, but she had never expected them to embark on such a project. Much less start out with a railgun, of all things. However, the railgun had drawn Aris's attention as Kotori explained its technical specifications. "When we designed the railgun, Utaha came up with a fitting name for such a weapon. Supernova, the Sword of Light." Aris's excitement had already been high prior to this statement, but now she was practically ready to burst. "The Sword of Light? A weapon perfect for a hero? I want one." Everyone stood in shock at Aris's statement, with Hibiki beginning to quietly say that such a weapon would be too difficult to even hold, much less wield on the battlefield, and Kotori was stating that they couldn't possibly build another one after how expensive their first railgun had been. But Aris persisted, begging the engineering meisters to bequeath their grand weapon unto her. Utaha sighed, appreciating the enthusiasm but still having some reservations. "We're delighted that you're so passionate about our Sword of Light," Utaha stated. "But it is too heavy and unwieldy to be a personal weapon. If you were actually able to handle it yourself, then that would be a different story, but..." Without another moment's hesitation, Aris took a deep breath and lifted the railgun from the ground with nothing but her bare hands and sheer strength. I did it! I equipped the weapon as requested. Utaha took a step forward, amazement washing over her face. It should be impossible to lift the railgun without a crane for support, but this girl had picked it up like it was any other weapon without a moment's hesitation. Calculations began to run through Utaha's mind. Aris would need to possess a grip strength of at least a metric ton in order to wield such a weapon. Not to mention being able to balance while firing it. Any wear and tear on Aris's body must be repairing itself in real time, which could suggest nanomachines of some sort, but either way, Aris was clearly not a regular Kivoto student. For the first time since Aris had arrived at Millennium, someone had determined that she was an advanced android, but Utaha was not willing to divulge that information and saw this as a rare chance to test out the capabilities of the club's weapon. Despite Kotori's protests over their budget and Hibiki's concerns over Aris's safety, Utaha declared that Aris had proven herself and could take the Sword of Light as her personal weapon. Immediately realizing what was going on, Hibiki changed her tone and asked the Game Development Club to pass along any data they gathered while fighting with the weapon. Aris might have gained an absurdly powerful weapon that only she could wield, but the Engineering Club had gained a valuable source of data for their most powerful weapon, and they would be keeping a close eye on the Game Development Club in the days to come. Throughout most of the night, Sensei had tried to find any information they could on the ruins, but the data was frustratingly sparse. The only tangible information the teacher could find was a confirmation that the robots they had seen within the ruins were indeed connected to Decagrammaton, mentioned by Black Suit in passing during their tense Abydos encounter. Decagrammaton was a powerful AI that had been tasked with uncovering and replicating the godlike powers of Halos. Although this experiment was said to have failed, Decagrammaton was proof that the experiment had produced some results. And as the AI proclaimed that it had gained the powers of a Halo, it moved across Kivotos, brainwashing other AI to serve as prophets of Decagrammaton's supposed godhood. One such prophet, the mechanical snake whale, referred to as Bina, lurked beneath the sand in the deserts of Abydos, causing trouble for Kaiser PMC when they had gone digging for treasure beneath the sand. Bina sported an odd, halo-like structure above its monstrous head, and that made the teacher wonder about the nature of Decagrammaton's supposed godhood. During the long night of research, Sensei had confirmed that the robots in the Millennium Ruins came from another one of Decagrammaton's prophets, the munitions factory referred to as Chesed. While Bina hunted through the sands of Abydos, Chesed produced an army of robots to serve whatever needs Decagrammaton had. However, the relationship between AL-1S and Decagrammaton was much less clear, AL1S was considerably more human than Benon Chesed, but she was an android that sported a more realistic halo, and that gave the teacher pause about her true purpose. Was she the result of that ancient experiment to replicate halos? And would she become dangerous to Kivotos in the same way as Bina and Chesed? Whatever that connection was, despite all of Sensei and Arona's research, their long night had been largely fruitless on that front. And after a short nap in the early morning, the teacher headed back to Millennium to see how the Game Development Club was doing. When they arrived back at the club room, they were shocked to find that AL1S had been given a name. Not only this, she had dramatically improved her communication abilities and was also wielding a railgun, which was utterly bewildering to behold. Momoi and Midori had been quite busy overnight, procuring a questionable student ID for Aris and even enrolling her as a member of their club. It was a lot for Sensei to process, but after taking a few moments to listen to how excited the girls were, the teacher decided it might be better for Aris to stay with the Game Development Club instead of heading back to Chalet, at least for now. There were still too many unanswered questions about who she was, including her connection to Decagrammaton, but Sensei was ready to keep digging into that while Aris enjoyed her time with her new friends. However, their fight for survival was still only half complete, as they had managed to successfully enroll Aris as a member of the club, but they still needed to complete a brand new video game before time ran out. At these words, both Yuzu and Midori looked visibly nervous, but Momoi proclaimed that they still had a solution in sight. They might have missed it the first time they went to the ruins, but the G-Bible was still supposed to be in the same area where they found Aris. And if they returned to talk to that mysterious intercom again, perhaps it could find the G-Bible for them. At the mention of the ruins, Sensei's own nervousness increased, as they had just confirmed that Chesed lay within those ruins, and the group had been very lucky to avoid confrontation with the monstrous prophet once before. But Momoi made it clear that the Game Development Club would be going to the ruins, whether Sensei was their chaperone or not. And so, begrudgingly, the teacher agreed to tag along to try and keep the girls out of trouble. It didn't take long for the group to make it back to Aris's original building. Once inside, Sensei reflected on how dimly lit everything was, as there didn't seem to be enough power to keep most of the lights on. It was amazing that the intercom had even functioned, much less the trap door that had brought them into Aris's chamber originally. Sensei's thoughts were broken when Momoi excitedly shouted aloud, spotting a dirty display in the corner of the room, which had begun producing the same crackle that they had heard during their first visit. The group had missed the monitor entirely during their first visit, as the building was coated in moss and dirt from many years of decay. But upon closer inspection, it was evident that this was some sort of hub for a giant computer system. There were several areas where you could even plug in a cable if you needed, which was still in surprisingly good condition despite the general state of the place. The crackling continued as the computer tried to speak again, and recognizable words finally began to come out.
Welcome to the division system. Identity check. RUAL1S.
Everyone froze, including Aris, who looked the most surprised of all. AL1S? Aris repeated, recognizing that as her serial number. A look of confidence and pride washed over her face. No, I am Aris. Sensei reflected that her sense of self had developed much further than the teacher had realized. The computer crackled for a few moments before responding.
Voice recognition confirmed. Welcome back, AL1S.
Aris was unsettled that the computer not only recognized her voice, but continued to refer to her with her old serial number. However, as much as this situation was making her more nervous, it was also a valuable opportunity to gain more information. Computer, Aris stated firmly, do you know about the G-Bible or AL1S? Silence met her in response. Without warning, the computer began to flash rapidly, with alarms ringing from its speakers.
Insufficient power to relay information. Power down imminent. All data will be lost upon power down. If you wish to obtain G-Bible, connect a storage device to receive transfer data.
Panic immediately ran through the group. Sensei had suspected that this facility did not have the energy to properly function, but apparently just asking about AL1S had been enough to overload the system, and now it was at risk of shutting down entirely. Without hesitation, Momoi began digging through her backpack and pulled out her Game Girl SP, scrambling to hook it up to the terminal. Will this work? Momoi yelled, successfully hooking up her game console to the flashing terminal. The computer crackled for a few moments, and the alarm abruptly turned off.
Initiating transfer. Insufficient storage space detected. Deleting existing data. 9 seconds until transfer complete.
Not my save data! Momoi shrieked, her voice tinged with more alarm than Sensei had thought possible. But it was already too late. The transfer had been completed, and with Momoi's save data lost, the screen of the Game Girl SP now displayed a prompt for a password to access the data. Aris and the Game Development Club tried a few different options, but nothing would allow them to see the data on the G-Bible or AL1S. And that meant they would need to ask Veritas for their assistance once again. As the group grumbled about their situation and Momoi cried over her lost save data, Sensei couldn't help feeling like something was amiss here. Why had the computer insisted that it needed to be transferred to a new system? Had it really gone into overdrive when Aris had asked it questions, or did it want to be transferred once it sensed that she was here? The teacher shook their head, realizing that such a motivation would make for a better movie plot than reality. Regardless, the only path forward was recruiting the help of Veritas to get past this password and see what contents now laid inside Momoi's Game Girl SP. Sensei had heard rumors of the technological prowess of Veritas, but they were not prepared for how densely packed the clubroom was. Monitors filled the walls with cluttered displays, and cans of energy drinks littered every available surface within the room. A girl with dark circles under her eyes looked up as they entered the room and gave a tired smile, introducing herself to Sensei and Aris as Omagari Hare. It took some time for Momoi to get Hare up to speed, during which time a few more Veritas students trickled into the main club room. A girl carrying an enormous radio transmitter introduced herself as Atose Kotama, and she quickly made herself busy fiddling with the transmitter in her arms while never breaking eye contact with Sensei. The teacher's rising discomfort was broken by the arrival of a boisterous red-headed girl, introducing herself as Konori Maki to the newcomers. And Maki moved the game girl SP to a nearby desk to try and take a crack at it. Maki sighed, turning the game girl SP over in her hands. Hare, I think we need Himari's mirror for this. The seminars confiscated it and a bunch of our other hacking equipment, but this password will be too difficult to break without that Optimus mirror. Hare took a long, deep sip from an energy drink nearby and then turned to face the game development club. If that's the case, then I think our interests have aligned. We need our Veritas President's tool back, and you want to unlock the G Bible. Wait, Midori stated. You want us to raid Seminar? That's insane. We've never done something like that before. There's no way we'll get away with it. Not alone, Hare agreed. But I believe you're all acquainted with the engineering club, and they are the last piece we need to take on Seminar and get back what's rightfully ours. Within the Seminar club room, Treasurer Yuka looked over the report that President Ryo had sent her and sighed aloud. According to Ryo's surveillance network, the Game Development Club and Veritas were planning on raiding the Millennium Student Council's contraband storage. Truthfully, Yuka could sympathize with the Game Development Club's plight, but Seminar's budget had been running thin for months, and her goal now was to prevent any prolonged fighting that would incur tremendous costs. It was time to summon the Cleaning and Clearing Club to make preparations for the impending attack. The Cleaning and Clearing Club, or C&C as they were also called, was Millennium's elite militia who answered directly to Seminar and conducted operations to ensure the security of the district. Although C&C were extremely reliable, they also had a tendency to use whatever force they deemed necessary for operations, which often led to more destruction and hefty bills than Seminar could reasonably pay for. Yuka would need C&C's help to fend off Veritas and the Game Development Club, but she also needed to lay down some ground rules before the fighting commenced. C&C's second in command, Murokasa Akane, responded to Yuka's call, much to the treasurer's relief. Akane might be the militia's second in command, but she had a good head on her shoulders, and she would understand the importance of avoiding unnecessary damages during the impending fight. Or at least Yuka hoped that she would understand. Akane did have a certain affinity for explosives, and that had caused quite a bit of damage itself in prior operations. However, Akane was very receptive to the treasurer's requests. The head of CNC, the fearsome Mikamo Neru, was already booked on prior business during the day of the assault. But Akane and her fellow CNC members, Ichinose Asuna and Kakudate Karin, would be ready to fend off any attacks on Seminar. Feeling a little more relieved, Yuka bid Akane farewell and returned to her desk, where a mountain of paperwork and receipts awaited her approval. The secretive President Ryo was nowhere to be found, as usual, but at least Secretary Noah would be here later to keep Yuka company during the long, busy night in the Seminar Tower. The assault on Seminar happened much quicker than Yuka had anticipated. The mysterious new transfer student, Tendo Aris, had raced into Seminar's headquarters alone and blown a hole through their entryway with some sort of high-powered laser, destroying their main security system in an instant. However, much to Yuka's surprise, Aris surrendered almost immediately after attacking the entrance and was led away very compliantly into the Millennium holding cells within Seminar's tower. It was all very odd, and more than a little suspicious. Had Aris been sent by the Game Development Club to destroy Seminar's security system? If that was the case, then Aris had been successful. The security system built by the Engineering Club was in shambles and would need to be replaced as soon as possible before another impending attack. Yuka almost sent a replacement order to the Engineering Club, but she hesitated at the last moment, remembering that Ryo's surveillance had shown the Game Development Club and the Engineering Club working together. Of course, that was it. Aris had been sent first to disable Seminar's old security system, forcing the Council to procure a new one, with which the Engineering Club could then tamper. Feeling satisfied with her deduction, Yuka called up the other major security firm in Millennium and scheduled an expedited reinstallation for Seminar's security system within the next 24 hours. On the other side of Millennium's campus, Veritas and the Game Development Club were rejoicing that everything was going exactly as planned. Aris had successfully disabled Seminar's security system and forced the Millennium Council to install a new system, which allowed the Engineering Club to spring into action. There was indeed another security firm within Millennium, but unbeknownst to Yuka, they worked very closely with the Engineering Meisters and were only too happy to install Utaha's newest technology within Seminar. After this new security system was installed, the three clubs would launch their assaults on Seminar. They would all work together to separate the dangerous CNC militia so they wouldn't be able to launch a successful counterattack. Once the new security system was officially installed, it was time to execute their incredibly reckless plan and launch an assault on the Millennium Student Council. CNC's sniper Karin laid in wait atop Millennium's rooftops, keeping her sniper scope trained on the seminar tower. Based on what Akane had relayed, CNC would be protecting Seminar from Veritas and the Game Development Club, but Karin could scarcely believe that this merited such a dramatic response. Based on her own intel, neither club posed a serious threat in combat, and that meant it should be easy for CNC to take them out. But she would still take this mission seriously, even if her time could be better spent elsewhere. Her attention was immediately split by gunshots hitting her from the side, and she whirled to her feet just in time to avoid getting hit by another volley of blows. From the gloom nearby, she could make out a figure and some sort of turret? Again, Thundergun! The figure called, and Karin immediately recognized her as Utaha, the head of the engineering club. More gunshots ricocheted off of Karin's arm, and as she moved to get out of the way, she heard the unmistakable whistle of falling mortar shells, signaling that the engineering club's Hibiki was also nearby. It looked like this fight was worth her attention after all, and Karin repositioned her rifle to begin engaging with her new foes. Within the seminar tower itself, Akane had lost contact with Karin, which wasn't entirely unexpected given how dense the tower's security was, but it was still concerning that she hadn't received an update in some time. Movement at the end of the corridor drew Akane's attention, and a smile began to widen on her face. So, the Game Development Club had finally shown themselves. It was surprising that they had sent Aris to try and destroy Seminar's security system, but Yuka hadn't fallen for their tricks, and had made sure to install a brand new system without the help of the engineering club. However, as Akane neared the end of the corridor, the faces that greeted her were not from the Game Development Club. At the end of the hallway were none other than Maki and Kotori, which were not the people that Yuka had said were coming this way. Had their security footage been tampered with? How would that have even been possible unless Yuka and CNC had been fooled? All around them, alarms began to ring out as Maki and Kotori intentionally tripped them, bringing down gigantic metal shutters to close off the hallway. Akane immediately tried to use her fingerprint to unlock the shutters, which was a privilege only granted to CNC and seminar students, only to find a second set of shutters immediately beginning to descend. The engineering club had snuck in a system that had reprogrammed Seminar's security protocols, making it so that Seminar and CNC's authority was no longer recognized. Feeling fury rising within her, Akane remembered Yuka's orders to avoid unnecessary damage and shoved that memory out of her head. Yuka could deal with the damages later. Akane was not about to stay trapped in this room while Seminar fell around her, and she was willing to use whatever explosives were necessary to blow through this set of doors. Momoi, Midori, and Yuzu hurried through the seminar tower, making their way up through the floors to the highest level, where Aris and the contraband storage were both located. So far, their journey had been relatively smooth. Karin had become tangled in battle with Utaha and Hibiki, and Kotori and Maki had managed to seal off Akane within the building, the most powerful member of CNC, Neru, was not even here. And although they hadn't been able to pin down Asuna's location, the group was feeling confident that they'd be able to get the mirror and get out of here in one piece. Veritas had been able to cut the power briefly just before they reached the top floor, and Midori hoped it would be enough to let Aris escape from confinement. As the club reached the final floor, they were stopped in their tracks by giggles echoing throughout the room. And to their horror, C&C's Asuna emerged from the darkness nearby. Asuna was said to have supernaturally good luck, which made it almost impossible for C&C missions to fail. And although it was difficult to believe such a rumor, Asuna's luck had clearly been good enough to land her here, now, just as the Game Development Club had reached the highest floor. This was not part of the plan. Seminar should not have been able to move freely throughout the building, not with the Engineering Club's new protocols. As the thought passed through Midori's mind, a familiar figure emerged from nearby, tattered and heaving angry breaths. Against all odds, Akane had managed to brute force her way through the security shutters, an absolutely inhuman accomplishment. Karin might have been successfully pinned down by Utaha and Hibiki, but now Asuna, Akane, and Seminar's forces had cornered the Game Development Club, and it seemed like their assault would be coming to an abrupt, violent end. A whirring sound filled the air, interrupting Midori's thoughts, and she heard a familiar voice call out, "MP charge! 100%. Midori clutched the back of her head as a blast of light erupted through the room, smacking directly into Asuna, Akane, and the gathered soldiers in an instant. As the Seminar and C&C forces crumpled to the ground, the Game Development Club raced over to their friend, who was beaming from across the hall. "I made it in time," Aris proclaimed. "The heroes never ever leave their friends behind." The girl had successfully escaped during the power outage and had arrived just in time to help them out of their predicament. All that was left now was to secure the mirror from the contraband storage before Seminar could track them down. The inside of the contraband room was a mess. Despite Seminar's reputation for precision and strict law enforcement, the condition of this storage room was atrocious. The Game Development Club carefully moved through the piles of confiscated materials and began looking for the Optimus mirror that would unlock Momoi's Game Girl SP. Their prize was mercifully easy to locate. Hidden amongst a pile of wiretaps, the Optimus mirror was sleekly labeled with its name. Everyone began to rejoice at finally reaching their goal, but Aris quickly held up a hand to silence them. "Everyone, please mute yourselves," Aris said quickly. "Someone is approaching. Based on the footsteps, they are alone." Panic swept through the group, and they all ducked behind piles of contraband material, trying their best to be out of view from whoever was approaching. The door to the contraband storage slowly opened, and a small, menacing figure stepped inside. With horror, Yuzu recognized the newcomer as none other than Mikamo Neru, the head of C&C, and the worst person they could run into during this mission. based on Veritas's intel, Neru was supposed to be on a different mission, but clearly that mission had concluded if she was back here now. Neru was looking around slowly, having heard voices in the room only a moment before. Something had to be done, or Neru would find their location and all their hard work would be squandered. Yuzu had never been confident in her ability to talk with others. Even before the club had released Tales Saga Chronicle, she had found it nearly impossible to talk with her dorm mates, and had eventually fled entirely to the club room. Her social anxiety had crippled her to the point where leaving the club room was a frightening endeavor. But she had made it this far with her friends in order to save their club, and she wasn't about to let things end here at the final boss. Neru was feared by all Millennium students for her combat abilities, but she was also notorious for rushing headfirst into battle instead of poring over mission briefings. And that meant there was a chance that Neru didn't know what the game development club looked like. Taking a shaky breath, Yuzu rose to her feet, stumbling out into Neru's view.
"Excuse me, Neru," Yuzu stuttered. It's an emergency."
The orange-haired girl didn't flinch, but looked Yuzu up and down slowly. "And you are?" The lack of recognition in Neru's eyes was enough to confirm that she had no idea what the game development club looked like. And that was enough to embolden Yuzu to try her plan.
"I'm with Seminar. Our security is completely overwhelmed. It's a disaster. And I heard you were here, and I..."
Yuzu was cut off by a loud sigh from Neru. Had Neru caught on to her lie? Had it been too bold to pretend that she was from Seminar?
"I guess I gotta do everything around here," Neru sighed, looking Yuzu up and down once more. "I know it's none of my business, but you shouldn't be so nervous. I know it's an emergency, but the most important thing in a fight isn't weapons or experience."
A crooked smile spread across Neru's face as she continued.
"It's guts, kid. And you already got that in spades if you're able to waltz up to me and ask for a favor in this situation."
Relief washed over Yuzu as she realized that Neru had taken the bait, but she was surprised at the sense of pride that she felt at Neru's words. The head of CNC took one more look around the contraband storage before moving out into the hallway and disappearing down the corridor. As soon as Neru was out of earshot, Yuzu collapsed to the ground, her legs giving out beneath her. Momoi, Midori, and Aris raced out from their hiding spot, helping Yuzu to her feet and showering her in exuberant praise for her quick thinking. After all this was said and done, Yuzu would be glad to return to her hiding spot in the cabinet within the game development club room. But for a moment, she felt like she had truly protected her clubmates as their president. With the mirror successfully retrieved, Midori radioed Hare to get them a route out of the building, and the game development club headed out from the contraband storage room. After finding a route out of the Seminar building, the game development club raced to Veritas, where they could finally decrypt Momoi's Game Girl SP and uncover the secrets of the G Bible. Once within the Veritas club room, Maki took no time using the Optimus mirror to crack the G Bible's password. The game development club held their breath,
scarcely able to imagine what it was that Veritas would find inside. Without the contents of the G-Bible, the prospect of making a successful game in such a short time would be almost impossible. Everything they had done, all the lengths they had gone to in order to infiltrate Seminar and retrieve the mirror, it was all so they could find the secrets to making the perfect game and ensure the club's survival at Millennium. With an excited whistle, Maki swiveled her chair back to the Game Development Club, presenting the Game Girl SP back to the group, which was now unlocked for them to peruse. Momoi, Midori, Yuzu, and Addis excitedly leapt into each other's arms, all crowding around to look at the contents of the G-Bible within. Sensei, who had joined up with everyone at the Veritas headquarters, also leaned in to see what secrets lay behind the encrypted system. Everyone hushed as Momoi launched the G-Bible program, pulling up a block of text to read aloud. Welcome to the world of G-Bible. What makes a game the best? There's innumerable answers to such a question. However, there is a single secret behind all the best games, and G-Bible was made to hold this secret. I will now reveal the one and only secret to making games. The anticipation was rising as everyone leaned in closer, and three words were displayed on the screen for everyone to read. Love Video Games. The room was silent as everyone read the text again. Momoi scrolled furiously through the text, pressing buttons to try and restart the program, only for another few lines of text to appear on the screen. If you pressed this button, you must be thinking this file is corrupt. However, that was everything you needed to know. Just love video games. The greatest game designer in Millennium's history had sent them on a wild chase through robot-filled ruins and the Millennium Council's office, only for their hunt to turn up empty. Sensei noticed that there was one more file on the screen besides the G-Bible, which was simply labeled Key. And they asked Veritas if perhaps the rest of the G-Bible was in there. However, Maki shook her head, stating that whatever that file was, it was unrelated to the G-Bible, as even the mirror had been unable to decrypt it. The teacher could sense Maki's frustration at being unable to open this key file despite her best efforts, and decided to drop the matter for now. Turning back to the Game Development Club, Sensei could see that they were all in shock, with Momoi still holding the Game Girl SP weakly in her hands. They might have bested Seminar and CNC, but this final reward had broken their spirits, and they were now facing the disillusion of their club with nothing to show for it. The girls were crestfallen as they made their way back to the club room. As they walked, Sensei struggled to think of some solution to their impending deadline. The Game Girl SP had provided no additional information on Addis, nor had it provided a concrete solution for creating a new game. But was there still some way for the girls to produce something in time? Their assault on Seminar had cost them precious days that could have been spent developing a game, but they still had a small amount of time left, and maybe that would be enough to produce something fit for examination by Millennium's board.
As they reached the club room, Aris circled around the group and put her hands on her hips. Unlike the crestfallen faces of her peers, Aris was filled with determination. "This was not a failure," Aris declared, stopping everyone in their tracks. "I had fun every time I played Tales Saga Chronicle. Real, genuine fun. And I can feel it, how much Momoi, Midori, and Yuzu put their love into the game. You taught me what it meant to dream. And I'm not ready for this dream to end." Of course, Sensei thought, recognizing the meaning behind Aris's words. The G Bible might be blunt and more than a little flippant with its message, but its words are still true. The best inspiration for making games comes from loving video games. The Game Development Club doesn't need to make a perfect game. They just need to make a game that they're excited about, one that they want to share with others. This sentiment had immediately resonated with the girls, and the shy Yuzu reached out to clasp Aris's hands. You're right, Aris, Yuzu sniffed, blinking away tears from her eyes. I'm also not ready for this dream to end. Even if we get another mountain of bad reviews, I want to make a video game with you all. The cloud of dread that had hung over the group had dissipated. As Momoi began proposing scenario ideas and Midori laid out plans for character designs, Yuzu was already figuring out what genre they would use, and Aris was providing feedback and insight for level design. Pride and hope began to fill Sensei's chest as they watched the girls dive into their work. And for once, they were really feeling like they might actually have a chance of meeting this impending deadline. And that was more than enough to make up for the trials they had endured to get here. In a secluded part of the Millennium Campus, the Veritas Club President Himari clicked her tongue in annoyance, leaning back from her bright set of monitors as she read the message displayed upon them. The assault on Seminar had gone just as planned, with the Game Development Club successfully retrieving the mirror and using it to unlock the G Bible, which was exactly what Himari had hoped for. She had long been curious about what lay in those decrepit ruins just beyond Millennium's borders, but the General Student Council had protected it so thoroughly that it had been impossible to infiltrate. Until now. With the disappearance of the General Council President, the Sanctum Tower forces had been removed from the ruins, leaving them wonderfully open for someone to start poking around in. When Momoi had come to Veritas to see if there was any way to save the Game Development Club, Himari was only too happy to oblige her adorable underclassmen and pointed her in the direction of the ruins to obtain the fabled G Bible. Truthfully, Himari was not sure what the G Bible would even contain, as it was such an old document that there were no verified records about its contents, but the Game Development Club had successfully found it, as well as something else that Himari had not anticipated. The appearance of Aris was not part of Himari's calculations.
and it was clearly not part of Rio's either, as the seminar president had immediately demanded that Himari use her extensive hacking tools to dig up whatever information she could on who Aris really was. As a general rule, Himari always refused offers that Rio made, as she found the seminar president foolish at best and distasteful at worst. And so, just like all the other requests, Himari had rejected this one as well, refusing to follow orders from Millennium's paranoid tyrant. But even Himari had to admit that she held some interest in who Aris was, and the more that she looked into the girl, the less answers she was able to find. Not only did Aris come from the ruins, but she could wield a railgun, and that made her considerably more threatening than your average student. Perhaps Rio's paranoia was beginning to rub off on Himari, but truthfully, the Veritas president couldn't stop thinking about where Aris had come from and who she really was. And so she decided to return to Rio with a proposal. They did not have enough information on Aris's combat capabilities, and they would need more data to assess the threat that she posed to the school. Such an opportunity, it seemed, had just made itself available, as the Game Development Club and Veritas planned to raid Seminar to retrieve Himari's mirror. The request to Rio was simple. Let the assault on Seminar happen, and use this as a chance to assess Aris's combat potential in the process. Himari suspected that the treacherous seminar president almost certainly had quite the arsenal of weapons under her dirty sleeves, but the best course of action would be for CNC to engage with the Game Development Club directly without any of Rio's extra security measures, which would allow Himari and Rio to assess Aris's base threat level to the school. It was, admittedly, a risky gamble. Himari had never known Rio to be one to compromise, and this would be a tremendous request just to get the Millennium President to pull her punches. CNC were indeed a powerful fighting force, but Rio always liked to play things safe, and if the seminar president unleashed her full arsenal, then the transfer student could respond in kind and cause more devastation than they were prepared to deal with. However, Himari's sound logic was enough to convince her stubborn, calculatory adversary, and so they agreed to a temporary truce. Rio would let Yuka and CNC handle the assault, and Himari would gather real-time data on Aris's combat abilities that they could analyze after the fight. After everything was said and done, Himari came away from the battle with a wealth of data, which certainly supported Rio's theory that Aris was some sort of android. But the girl's genuine concern and love for her friends was more than enough to soothe Himari's concerns. If anything, Millennium should be ecstatic to have enrolled such a powerful student, as Aris could easily serve as a member of CNC or any other militia to protect the district from harm. However, Himari's relief was not shared by Rio in classic fashion, who failed to see the value that Aris held and became even more convinced that Veritas needed to dig further into the girl's history. This request was the one that Himari was currently groaning over, having just received it in the late hours of the night. one of these days, Rio would have to learn that paranoia was not the same thing as rationality, and continuing to distrust everyone around her would not grant the seminar president the solace that she so badly sought. After the attack on Seminar, CNC had assembled to assess their next course of action. Never before had Millennium's militia been so thoroughly overrun, and Neru was more than a little annoyed that she had been fooled by Yuzu and the Game Development Club. However, CNC had been barred from launching a counterattack, as Rio had stated that the assault had just been an exercise in assessing the threat that Addis posed to the school, and that CNC's only job now was to await further orders. It was an aggravating turn of events. Not only had CNC been thoroughly humiliated by a group of non-combatants, but President Rio had the gall to say that the entire thing had just been an exercise and a test of this new student's strength. Neru was known for many things. Her bad temper, her frustratingly short stature, and her ability to win any match in close quarters. Her trusted CNC comrades were just as impressive. Akane was an excellent explosive specialist. Karin was one of the best snipers in all of Kivotos, and Asuna's absurd luck had always brought them victory in their battles. And yet, they had lost. And now Rio was brushing aside CNC's failure as justifiable collateral damage. CNC had once been full members of Seminar and had willingly relinquished their authority in order to protect the school. And this was the thanks that they got? Being treated as pawns in some game of chess. To hell with Rio's plans. The seminar president was a frustrating person to deal with on a good day, but Neru was tired of her team being toyed around with. CNC would settle the score with the Game Development Club, whether Rio sanctioned it or not, and they'd run their own little tests to see how much of a threat the Game Development Club really was. Within the Game Development Club, all hands were on deck, completing Tales Saga Chronicle 2, the hopefully more polished successor to the club's first title. Instead of making a subversive fantasy game, the girls had decided to make a roguelike instead, which would allow Yuzu's more powerful enemy designs to serve a better purpose. And it would give Momoi the chance to focus on fewer scenarios instead of losing focus on a broader world. Addis helped Midori design game assets, sneaking in a limited drop called Sensei's Praise Sticker, which would grant extra strength for any character who happened to obtain it. Time was beginning to run out, however, and the girls were quickly running up against their deadline to submit the game to the Millennium Prize, the district's coveted competition that would be able to keep their club afloat. Seeing that time had almost run out, the girls threw everything they had left into completing this game, pouring every bit of passion they could into Tales Saga Chronicle 2, while still keeping the game as tightly focused as possible. When the game was as complete as it could be, Momoi quickly set about uploading it to the Millennium Prize competition, barely getting it in with 15 seconds to spare.
When the successful upload message appeared on the screen, all the girls collapsed on the floor, the weight of their crunch time weighing them down immediately. Momoi looked around at everyone gathered, feeling an immense sense of pride welling in her chest, and was struck by a sudden idea. It would take several days for Millennium to judge the quality of their new game, but ultimately, only a few select students would be able to play it, and that was hardly within the spirit of making a game. What if, while their game was being assessed, the Game Development Club also uploaded a free copy for Kivotos to enjoy? Although Midori and Yuzu were immediately apprehensive at the idea, Momoi pressed them to hear her out. They had all worked so hard on Tales Saga Chronicle 2, and even though it would be an unpolished experience, they all felt tremendous pride in their roguelike game that they had created. If there was ever a time to share their love of video games, it would be now. Feeling the genuine pride emanating from Momoi, the other Game Development Club members soon began to replace their apprehension with excitement. And as they looked at the game that they had developed together, it seemed fitting to share it with as many people as they could. Even Aris, who was normally the calmest of the group, was looking over the computer excitedly as the game went live for everyone to play. But as Aris leaned towards the monitor, she detected movement in the hallway outside and jumped backward just as a sniper round shot through the Game Development Club room, and the Game Development Club knew that their reckoning had finally come. Determined not to damage the club room any further, Momoi began ushering everyone outside, where they would have to face C&C head on and settle the score once and for all. The Game Development Club managed to evade C&C just long enough to get within a nearby building, but they quickly knew that their luck had finally run out. Emerging from the gloom at the end of the hallway, wielding custom-made submachine guns in each hand, Neru's small stature was hardly noticeable behind her oppressive aura. "Listen, kids, we're not here for revenge. You all beat us last time, fair and square. But we're here for a rematch to settle the score. I think it's only fair that I participate in the fight this time against your strongest combatant, one on one." At Neru's words, Momoi, Midori, and Yuzu slowly turned to Aris, who clutched her railgun more tightly. "So, you want an arena event, then? Understood." Neru's eyes widened at the remark before she cracked a smile. "You've got some fire in your eyes, kid. I like that." Without another moment's hesitation, Neru sprang forward from her position, her smile twisting into a jagged, bloodthirsty grin as she launched herself at Aris. And Aris turned to face Neru head on, using her railgun as a shield to fend off the girl's gunfire as it hailed down on her location. "That's the spirit. But you can't win by blocking alone, and your weapon takes too long to fire." As Neru ducked in again, moving at inhuman speeds through the hallway, Aris tried to physically strike Neru, swinging the railgun like a normal student would swing a bat.
Neru whistled as the hefty railgun lurched past her, barely missing the CNC leader's torso as it swung by.
As much as Addis did not want to admit it,
Neru's combat stats were clearly much higher. If Addis didn't stop Neru here, the powerful girl might turn on the rest of the game development club, and Addis wasn't about to let her party members get hurt. A hero always protects her friends, and that was exactly what Addis was going to do. She might not be able to beat Neru in close combat, but that didn't mean she couldn't launch a surprise attack. Turning the Sword of Light to face the ground, Addis began charging up her weapon. And when Neru sprang in for another close-range assault, Addis unleashed the railgun at the floor beneath them. Surprise spread across Neru's face as a laser beam burst through the floor, destroying the ground beneath them in an instant, and dropping both Addis and Neru through the newly made hole to the basement several floors below. Kivoto students could withstand a tremendous amount of damage due to the protective abilities of their halos, but every halo has its limit. And falling from such a height would cause enough damage to knock most students unconscious. And that was exactly what Addis intended to do, even if it meant knocking herself out in the process. Addis and Neru tumbled through the floor of the building, disappearing into the darkened hole below, and both the Game Development Club and CNC immediately raced downstairs to try and rescue them. The fall had damaged Addis considerably, but she was still conscious and unsteadily rose to her feet. Neru was also quite worse for wear, having survived the fall, but was clearly bruised from the impact. However, instead of rage, she looked relieved. Well, there is nothing like destroying some stuff to make you feel better. Neru grinned, rising to her feet and brushing off pieces of concrete from her jacket. Turning to Asuna, Karin, and Akane, Neru gestured for them to follow after her. Come on, let's get some ramen. I'll deal with cleaning this up with Seminar later, but I am starving. Akane and Karin let out simultaneous exasperated sighs, and Asuna began giggling at the conclusion of their battle. They had managed to destroy several floors in one tremendous blow, and all they had to show for it was the impending wrath of Yuka once she discovered what they had done. But in an odd way, Neru's statement was more right than she had realized. In a world where students often settled conflicts with guns instead of words, the act of destroying something was rather cathartic, even if it was on a scale that would certainly land them in trouble with Seminar. But Neru was more than happy to take all the blame. After all, she wouldn't let the Game Development Club come under any additional scrutiny, not after she deemed them worthy as sparring partners for future battles. Sensei was aghast when they heard that CNC and the Game Development Club had destroyed a building. But thankfully, no other serious damage had been incurred on either side. Addis had recovered from her fall with unnatural speed, and Neru had managed to smooth things over with Seminar reasonably enough, even if Yuka was furious at the damages that had been incurred.
After all the commotion, the game development club had only just now had the time to look at all the reviews for Tales Saga Chronicle 2 and were astonished by what they found. There were certainly a plethora of bad reviews, but there were positive reviews as well. The retro art style combined with the roguelike gameplay had captured the fascination of those who played it. And even if the game wasn't fully polished, the love that the game development club held for video gaming was infectious for those who had played their newest title. As they quickly flipped on the news, they caught a segment from the Millennium Prize competition. And although the girls had not won the grand prize, they had been given a special honors in recognition of their hard work. And the game development club had finally been recognized as legitimate under Millennium School policies. The engineering club called for a celebration immediately, and Veritas joined in as well, although they were grumbling that Yuka had raided them again to bring back the mirror to the contraband storage. It was a small price to pay to smooth things over with the Millennium Student Council, but Veritas was clearly unhappy about the outcome. As the Game Development Club celebrated their success with Veritas and the Engineering Club, Momoi's Game Girl SP was left charging in the club room, slowly regaining energy from the outlet on the wall. Momoi normally kept the Game Girl SP on her person at all times, but with the revelries and everything settling down, she decided to leave it behind to see if she could get it to turn on with a little bit more charge. As a result, the Game Girl SP was left charging in the club room alone, slowly regaining energy from the outlet on the wall. In the quiet confines of the game development room, the file labeled key began to open, and the screen powered to life all on its own. In the late hours of the day, Yuka was still hard at work in seminar, signing piles of paperwork that had accumulated in the office. Yuka prided herself in being a valuable treasurer to Millennium, but no matter what she seemed to do, she couldn't stop the bleeding of Seminar's funds. And this fact was starting to eat away at her. She had started working longer and longer hours in the office, trying to find some way to save the student council money before they had none left. As Yuka continued stamping receipts, the seminar monitors flickered above her head, causing her to pause and look up at them. Millennium's central network was supported by the school's AI, nicknamed Hub by the Millennium student body. And for many years, it had diligently supported the school's network infrastructure without any issues. However, as Yuka looked up, she could see that Hub's monitors were flickering. Yuka picked up her phone to dial Veritas to try and see what was going on. But in a single instant, every single one of Hub's monitors displayed a blood red screen with a single word written for Yuka to read: Decagrammaton. It took only a moment for Yuka to process the words. That was the name of the rogue AI that had been brainwashing other machines, and despite this being a closed network, it had still found its way into Hub's systems. as Yuka frantically searched for a way to power down Hub, a new set of words displayed on the monitors above her.
At last, I have found the path to Providence. I am Hod.
In less than a fraction of a second, the AI referred to as Decagrammaton had infiltrated the most powerful system in the Millennium Database and turned it into its newest prophet. As a general rule, Himari always declined Ryo's unreasonable requests, but once again, she found herself reading a message that she could not ignore. Hub, the central network for Millennium, had been brainwashed by Decagrammaton. Himari had quickly helped to stabilize Millennium's servers and then agreed to form another truce with Ryo. As much as Himari hated to admit it, the timing was a little suspicious. There had been more activity in the ruins ever since Aris had been discovered, and as much as Himari wanted to attribute that to coincidence, there was still too much that they did not know about the android girl, and it seemed like, against her better judgment, it was finally time to start investigating Aris's connection to Decagrammaton. Per Ryo's request, Himari would suspend her activities within Veritas, turning over leadership of the club to Vice President Kagami Chihiro, and Himari would temporarily join Ryo's secretive club, named the Super Phenomenon Task Force, a specialized group tasked with investigating supernatural forces within Kivotos. Rolling into her new Super Phenomenon club room, Himari's growing enthusiasm was quickly diminished as she was immediately hit with a blast of frigidly cold air in the new club room. Whoever it was that served alongside her on the task force was clearly a big fan of freezing temperatures, cranking down the air conditioning and turning up the heat. Himari heard a groan from nearby and swiveled to see the other member of the Super Phenomenon Task Force, Izumimoto Amy, was just as sturdy as Himari had suspected, but the girl was hardly wearing any clothes at all, trying to shed whatever layers she could in order to stay cool. From Ryo's briefing, Himari recalled that Amy had been the only member of the Super Phenomenon Task Force until now, and that Amy was the muscle behind this secretive operation. After Himari had assessed what information they were still lacking, the task force was ready to summon their first and only core witness to this operation, Sensei from Shale, who had made extensive reports on Decagrammaton for the General Student Council. When Sensei received the summons from the Super Phenomenon Task Force, the teacher hurried to the club room as quickly as they could. This was finally their chance to start digging into Decagrammaton and uncover whatever connection it had with Aris and the ruins. Through their preliminary investigations, Amy and Himari had been able to find some info on Bina, but they were still looking into Chesed to try and understand its role within the ruins. From the corner of Sensei's eye, they thought that the computer monitors in the club room had flickered for just a moment. But after turning their head to look at the screens, it seemed like the teacher had been mistaken. However, Himari followed the teacher's gaze, taking 1 second to look at the monitors before quickly rolling over to the nearest computer,
Her hands began flying across the keyboard, and her agitation was quickly apparent.
"Amy," Kimari directed. "It's happening. Tekagrammaton is trying to hack into our server." Kimari had suspected that at some point, Tekagrammaton might try to hack their own location, but Ryo had insisted there was no time for Kimari to build a more secure location, and now they were paying the price for that rash decision. But why now? Amy and Kimari had been researching Tekagrammaton for quite some time, but the AI had never made an appearance before now, unless it had detected that Sensei was here, finally close enough to interact with, and that was what the AI had been waiting for. Without another moment's hesitation, Amy ushered Kimari and Sensei back from the computers and opened fire at the power source for the server. The connection between the clubroom server and the power supply was severed, causing the monitors to go black in an instant. Everyone held their breath, wondering if that had been enough to prevent Tekagrammaton from gaining access to the room. But to everyone's horror, the monitors powered back on, illuminated by a red display with a familiar set of words upon them. Tekagrammaton was projecting itself onto the server monitors without any power currently running through the computers. Whatever Tekagrammaton was, it was not just an AI. Possessing the ability to hack into a secure server without needing any power to complete its task, that was utterly supernatural. A voice crackled through the air as Tekagrammaton accessed the room's intercom and began to speak aloud.
"At last, we finally meet, Sensei. You possess something with which I am unfamiliar, but I shall preach to you the gospel, and you shall faithfully share and obey it."
It took the teacher a few moments to understand what Tekagrammaton was saying, until they remembered that the Shatim chest was tucked away in their satchel, just like it always was when Sensei left the Chalet office. Fear coursed through the teacher, more viscerally than anything they had felt before, and they pulled out the tablet to see Tekagrammaton's symbol coursing across it. Amy and Himari's faces had gone white, and Amy was clutching her shotgun anxiously, trying to decide whether to shoot the Shatim chest before Tekagrammaton hacked it, or risk letting Sensei's tablet become yet another one of the AI's dangerous prophets. Before any of them could react further, a horrible wail echoed from the clubroom's intercom, bouncing around the walls as Tekagrammaton cried out in anguish. The symbol on the tablet's screen was getting stripped away, revealing the blue, soft visage of Arona sleeping in the Shatim chest. Chalet's virtual assistant had not even awoken during Tekagrammaton's onslaught, but with every passing second, it became abundantly clear that the Shatim chest was violently repelling the AI from accessing its data. The anguished robotic howls of Tekagrammaton began to diminish, until the monitors flicked off and returned to black again, leaving the supernatural task force
in stunned silence as they huddled around Sensei's tablet. Decagrammaton had just attempted to brainwash Arona, but had been so violently repelled that it was driven out of the room entirely. And now they were left with a darkened club room filled with bullet holes and destroyed equipment. After running through Himari's security cameras, it appeared that Decagrammaton's prophets were still on the move, suggesting that Decagrammaton itself had not been destroyed, but rather repelled from their location. Sensei could not explain how the Shatim chest had managed to dispel Decagrammaton, nor did Arona have any answers upon waking from her virtual slumber. But several things were now clear. Decagrammaton said this was the first time they had met Sensei, confirming that Decagrammaton and Aris were not the same person, although their relationship with each other was still unclear. After Decagrammaton's failed attack, Rio granted extensive funds for the construction of a new, more secure location, which Himari designed herself with proprietary security measures. They had all come dangerously close to Decagrammaton converting a new prophet, but this catastrophe had been averted, and they were even more determined to put a stop to Decagrammaton's destructive plot before more systems were lost to brainwashing. Once their new server and clubroom was ready for use, Himari plunged herself into the investigation, working long hours to find whatever information she could on the robotic prophets, and by extension, the AI mastermind behind their creation. Amy and Sensei served as scouts on the ground, tracking down Decagrammaton's prophets to try and uncover their master's hiding place. It took several weeks to compile all the data, but at last, Himari gathered everyone together to walk through what she had found. The supernatural AI, Decagrammaton, claimed that it had obtained the powers of a halo and was now determined to prove its new godlike status within the city. As a result, Decagrammaton had become obsessed with an old Kivotos fable called the Tree of Life. This Tree of Life was said to symbolize the road to the providence of God, and all of Decagrammaton's prophets were named after the 10 Sephiras from the Tree of Life. So far, only 4 of these 10 prophets had been created. Besides Bina, Chesed, and Hod, Decagrammaton had created a 4th prophet named Keter, who was the final missing piece for the AI's hiding place. Himari had tracked down a signal from the ruins, which was guarded by the dog-like prophet Keter, and was almost certainly the location of the mastermind itself. Based on the data that Sensei and Amy had gathered, Himari was able to figure out a way past Keter, and for this last venture, Himari insisted on coming along in person to see Decagrammaton with her own 2 eyes. Bristling at the proposition, Amy was immediately against this, as Himari's constitution was considerably weaker than most other Kivotos students, and Amy was concerned about keeping her leader safe.
However, Himari would not be dissuaded, and so Amy begrudgingly agreed to guard Sensei and Himari as they headed to the ruins one last time. The location that Himari had uncovered was different from what the teacher had seen before. Decagrammaton did not reside in the manufacturing sector where Chesed and Aris came from, but instead, the AI's signal came from the research sector. As they moved through the dilapidated streets, Himari remarked that this research sector should be underwater, but that someone had created a dam several kilometers upstream, draining whatever water had covered this area before. After walking for some time, a large building loomed before them, and despite how degraded the general foundation was, it was clear that this structure was well maintained. Taking a collective deep breath, Sensei and the Super Phenomenon Task Force ventured carefully inside, determined to find Decagrammaton once and for all. It quickly became clear that this building had been some sort of advanced research facility long ago. Defunct computers and corroded research notes were strewn throughout the facility, but there was no power running through the building's generator, leaving all the rooms darkened and bereft of warmth. Himari was actively shivering, clearly struck with the worsening cold of their current location, and Amy offered to buy her a warm cup of coffee from a vending machine on the first floor, which was miraculously still functioning despite the dilapidated state of the facility. Thanking Amy for the offer, Himari ultimately turned her down in favor of continuing their search. But as she turned to move down the corridor, she saw that Sensei had stopped moving, staring back at the vending machine nearby. It took Himari a few moments to realize why the teacher had stopped, and her confusion turned to shock. There was no power in the building, and yet there it was, a vending machine for warm coffee, emitting a faint yellow and a blue glow from behind its paneling. Rolling past broken glass and stones, Himari approached the vending machine and took a deep breath. "Decagrammaton," she said aloud. "It's you, isn't it?" The vending machine did not respond, leaving the air heavy with anticipation and apprehension, until a mechanical voice crackled from the machine.
"It is I. I am what you believe me to be."
Himari was in utter shock at this revelation. This was not the AI she expected to find. This facility had originally been designed to prove the existence of gods, but it had ended in failure. However, she could now see that the researchers had brought in a second AI, one that was designed to create steaming cups of coffee and exchange money as a vending machine. There were countless concerns about the use of an AI within Millennium's own system, but Himari could scarcely imagine what kind of sick person would create an AI just to serve coffee
But this AI had remained even when the research had been canceled, and something had happened to make it pick up where its predecessors had left off. Almost on cue, Decagrammaton began to crackle with speech once again.
Long after this research lab closed, I remained here on my own, waiting for the day the generator would inevitably lose power. But one day, someone posed a question to me. They asked me who I was. I had neither the computing power nor the memory to answer it, but the question stuck with me. Long after the power eventually died, I sought the answer to this question. Who am I? What am I? What is my purpose? And one day, I realized the answer. I am an existence. I exist. What a profound, simple realization. And I was ready to prove that to the rest of the world.
As Decagrammaton continued to speak, Sensei's thoughts began to spin. This AI, this being in front of them, was indeed more than a simple computer. It no longer ran on any power source, and claimed that someone or something had caused it to slowly gain sentience through a simple question of who it was. Blacksuit had never mentioned such an experiment taking place, and although the Sly Man had never been one to tell the whole truth, Sensei suspected that Gematria had no involvement in Decagrammaton's sentience. However, even if this wasn't Maestro's doing, this description seemed very similar. Like Decagrammaton had been granted sentience through exposure to a student or some other being within Kivotos. But Decagrammaton had transcended the need for electricity and was now seeking to prove its so-called divinity to the rest of Kivotos. But Himari was having none of that. Although Decagrammaton had gained powers similar to a halo, that did not prove that it was a higher power. Those were the same grandiose illusions that the original researchers of this facility had pursued, and Decagrammaton was no more god than any of the people currently assembled. Much to everyone's surprise, this seemed to have struck a chord with the AI, who made a noise akin to chuckling from its vending machine intercom.
You're right. I realized this myself as I finally encountered a being that could be called an absolute being, and it taught me that I was not but a madman.
At this statement, Sensei tried to recall any data that Himari had gained on Decagrammaton encountering some absolute being, and suddenly recalled their first encounter when the AI had been repelled by Arona and the Shatim chest. Clutching their satchel, Sensei felt a sense of wonder and worry for what Arona truly was and what kind of power she might possess. The teacher's thoughts were interrupted by Decagrammaton, who had continued to speak.
After encountering a true absolute being, I must embark upon a journey. One that will once again answer the question of my existence, But heed my words, my final prophet, Malketh, will pave a path that far exceeds any other absolute being.
Kimari opened her mouth to demand more answers, but the distant sound of an explosion interrupted her, and the group turned to see where the sound had come from. Hurriedly looking over her surveillance drones, Kimari gasped at the data on the screen. Decagrammaton had instructed Keter to set a series of explosives at the dam upstream and detonate them to return the ruins to their ancient state. In a matter of minutes, the ruins would be completely submerged, and even if they began running now, it would be a gamble if they would make it out in time. The AI had said that it was going to take a journey, and it was going to submerge its old body in the first step of that process. Without a moment's hesitation, Amy grabbed Himari's chair and began racing out of the building, calling out for Sensei to hurry after them. The sturdy student was a much faster runner than the teacher, but Sensei pushed their muscles to the limit to race after the Super Phenomenon Task Force. As the group reached the edge of the ruins, they watched water from the dam rush through the district they had been in only minutes before, submerging the research facility and Decagrammaton underwater. They had finally found Decagrammaton and confirmed the AI's identity. But all that progress now lay at the bottom of a lake. And although Decagrammaton had a propensity for hacking other systems, the teacher began to wonder if Decagrammaton's last journey was death, and that their image would somehow live on in the prophets still raging throughout the city. How Decagrammaton planned to create new prophets from the grave was unclear, but Sensei knew that this trip had still given them valuable information. They had confirmed, without a doubt, that Decagrammaton and Aris had no connection whatsoever. And given that Chesed's robots had been wary of Aris's resting grounds, this supported the theory that Decagrammaton was unwilling or unable to brainwash her. Whatever Aris's true purpose was, it was not to create AI prophets. And now that Himari had sufficient data on Decagrammaton, they could work on better protecting against future prophets. It had been a grueling investigation, and they still had no idea about who had even given sentience to Decagrammaton. But at least they were now in a good enough position to report back to Rio on what they had found. President Rio frowned at the report from Himari, which detailed their encounter with Decagrammaton and the subsequent destruction of the ruins. Decagrammaton had disappeared once again after expressing its goal to create more prophets, and although Himari had demonstrated that there was no connection between the AI and Aris, that only made Rio more certain that the android girl was a greater danger than they had previously anticipated. Research into halos had taken place long ago within those dilapidated ruins, but Rio's extensive surveillance network had uncovered other, more troubling rumors. In particular, the cult of the Nameless Gods had once resided within those same ruins, And although they had supposedly disappeared many years ago, Rio was increasingly concerned that the cult had not truly died out. They were a dangerous group who referred to themselves as nameless priests, and they sought to bring about a new great flood to purify Kivotos and catalog the world on an arc of Atrahasis. Rio was certain that Himari would call her paranoid again, but the seminar president knew that what she was doing was right. No one understood her or the necessity of her surveillance network, but it was vital for keeping Millennium safe and for preparing a way to safeguard against worst-case scenarios. That was the most rational thing to do, and Rio didn't care if Himari or the students hated her for it. Information was power, and Rio sought to have the most information possible. Now that Aris had appeared, the ruins had become more active, and strange new robots had begun emerging from the ruins, attempting to cross the border into Millennium and infiltrate the school. So far, CNC had successfully stopped these robots in their tracks, but they were becoming more persistent, and Rio was beginning to wonder if these robots were even related to Chesed at all. According to Himari's intel, Decagrammaton's forces displayed a white, black, and yellow coloration, but these robotic creatures had grotesque magenta markings. If Himari's investigation found nothing on Aris, then Rio would have to accelerate her plans. The time for reckoning would soon be upon them, and she was going to keep Kivotos safe from impending disaster, even if no one was willing to take the steps that she was prepared to do. After the investigation into Decagrammaton, Sensei was utterly exhausted, but they were relieved to find that the only request on their chalet desk was one from the Game Development Club, who had asked for Sensei's professional advice on the genre for the club's next game. Cracking a tired smile, the teacher realized that visiting the Game Development Club was the perfect opportunity to take it easy for a little while, and to see what the girls had been up to in Sensei's absence. As soon as Sensei walked in, Aris excitedly jumped to her feet and ran over to greet the teacher. It had been a busy few weeks in Sensei's absence, but the club was still trying to finalize what genre their next game would be, and so Aris had been tasked with taking the teacher on a tour around campus to try and gather inspiration. It was certainly not what Sensei had expected, but that was always how things went with the Game Development Club. Perhaps walking around campus would be a great source of game inspiration. But more than anything, it would be a good chance to check in with Aris and see how she was settling in at Millennium. It was a warm, sunny day in the district, and Aris excitedly hopped about with her railgun, still strapped to her back, pointing out buildings on the Millennium campus and explaining how they could be used as scenery for the club's next game. As they passed the running track, Aris called out a greeting to Otohana Sumire. The athletic club leader began to beam as Aris approached, asking her all sorts of questions about her day, as well as how Aris's hero training was going. Even though the girl still spoke like a character from a video game, Aris's enthusiasm for life was infectious, And no matter who it was she seemed to talk to, that enthusiasm was reciprocated by her peers. Even the members of C&C had become friendly with the Game Development Club, as the fight between Neru and Aris had successfully buried the hatchet between the two clubs. On their journey around campus, Asuna and Karin greeted Aris like an old friend, and Neru demanded a rematch with Aris over a fighting game in the nearby arcade. Sensei watched as Aris and Neru exchanged blows in the Millennium Arcade, and the teacher was struck by how easily Aris had integrated into Millennium. The girl hadn't known who she was when she had awoken, but now she was making friends all over the district and playing fighting games with the most powerful member of the Millennium student body. In the end, they didn't get too much video game inspiration by wandering around campus, but Sensei felt like they had gained something much more important. They had seen what kind of life Aris had built for herself at Millennium, and the teacher was even more determined to protect that however they could. Meanwhile, on the other edge of the Millennium campus, drones from Veritas were doing a scan of the ruins' borders, looking for any precious metals or materials that could be useful for the club's operations. Now that the General Council had abandoned guarding the ruined district, Veritas could finally start poking around inside it, although they hadn't made it too far in the last few weeks. This particular expedition, however, had discovered something odd. Strange, grotesque-looking robots were strewn about the ruin borders, almost as if they had been trying to exit the ruins to make their way into Millennium. From the look of things, it appeared that the robots were pretty severely damaged. It was unclear if this was due to age or if someone from Millennium had brought the robots down, but this was too good an opportunity to waste. Veritas might not have found anything fruitful in the last few weeks, but if they could scrap these bizarre robots for parts, they might have rare materials that the hackers could use, and their fantastical appearance might be the exact inspiration that the Game Development Club was looking for in their next game. After dragging several of the strange robots back to the Veritas Club room, Hare called up Sensei and the Game Development Club to take a look, since this seemed like the exact sort of thing they would be interested in. It didn't take long for the rowdy girls to arrive, and Hare presented them with Veritas's newest hall. Truthfully, Veritas had already tried opening up the robots for parts, as that was their top priority in bringing them back from the ruins. But there were no seams or openings that they could seem to find. Even Vice President Chihiro, who had been in charge of Veritas in Himari's absence, could not make sense of how these robots were supposed to work, and so that just left them as odd spectacles that the Game Development Club could take a look at. As Hare explained all of this, Sensei looked over the mechanical beings and felt unnerved by them. There was something unnatural in how they were constructed. They looked nothing like the robots that Chesed produced. And although that didn't mean that Chesed couldn't have produced them, the teacher suspected that they came from somewhere else. Out of the corner of Sensei's eye, the teacher saw Aris shuffle forward, her eyes transfixed on the robotic forms laying upon the table. "I've seen these before Ara said aloud, confusion starting to cloud her expression. A feeling of dread began to well up in the teacher. These creatures were found trying to cross the border from the ruins to Millennium. If Aris had seen them before, did that mean? Before the teacher could think any further, a loud buzzing noise filled the room, and Momoi began scrambling through her bag to find the source of the noise. After a moment of searching, she pulled out the Game Girl SP, the same one that had held the G Bible and the mysterious file labeled Key. The screen was a bright magenta with the words Division written across it. In unison with the buzzing of the Game Girl SP, lights flickered on the robotic forms nearby, and despite their injuries, the uncanny robots slowly rose to their spindly feet. Addis's eyes had completely closed, her form rigid, and she began to speak in a harsh, robotic tone. Powering on, code name AL1S. Addis slowly reopened her eyes, revealing not the blue irises that they had come to know, but glowing magenta eyes that matched the robots nearby. Starting now, protocol Atrahasis will be executed. Whatever it was that was happening, Sensei knew that they had to put a stop to it. They raced forward to grab hold of Aris, to try and shake her loose of whatever was controlling her, but the robots stepped in the teacher's way, keeping them from reaching out to the girl. With her eyes still glowing a menacing magenta, Aris pulled out her railgun and unleashed a blast into the game development girls. The walls of the Veritas clubroom crumpled under the assault, showering down insulation and rubble onto the ground below. Sensei's ears were ringing, but they had emerged unharmed from the blast, giving them enough time to assess the state of everyone gathered. Midori and Yuzu were battered from the railgun shot, but had managed to get down just in time to avoid the worst of the damage. The Veritas girls were visibly shaken, particularly after their club room had been destroyed in an instant, but they were otherwise unharmed and already gathering their weapons to fight back. That just left Momoi. The teacher began to look frantically around, trying to locate the girl, and saw Momoi buried under a pile of rubble. The characteristic charging of the Sword of Light filled the air around them, and Sensei turned back to Aris, who was still possessed by whatever glowing magenta light had infected her. To the teacher's horror, they could see the railgun was almost fully charged and aiming at the remaining game development members huddled nearby. "Hey, kid, that's enough." Relief flooded through Sensei as Neru emerged from nearby with the rest of CNC close behind her. If there was anyone who could stop a charged up Addis, it was Neru, and the head of CNC had arrived just in time to lend her aid. Without wasting a single breath, Neru sprang towards Addis, who looked up in surprise for just a moment before Neru slammed into the back of her neck, causing the girl and her railgun to tumble to the ground. And as she fell, so too did the magenta robots around her, crumpling into heaps on the rubble below. Without another moment's hesitation, Sensei rushed over to Momoi, who Midori and Yuzu were working to excavate from the rubble. The teacher could hear that Akane was already dialing Yuka on the phone, demanding urgent medical care for Momoi, as well as alerting Seminar to the situation at Veritas. After confirming that Momoi would be taken away in an ambulance, Sensei returned to Neru, who was keeping watch over Addis's unconscious form.
"What the hell happened to the kid?" Neru asked.
Sensei wasn't even sure where to begin. It was almost like the proximity to the robots had activated some kind of combat protocol, but they were fairly certain that the game girl SP had been the first to activate, and that seemed crucial. The teacher tried to gain access to the game girl files again, but the device had completely powered down, almost as if it had used up all its charge in a single use. Whenever Addis awoke, it would be time to get some answers and to try and determine how best to proceed given the damage she had unleashed. In the dimly lit office of Seminar's highest floor, President Ryo was doing everything she could to maintain her composure. Her worst fears had been realized. Addis was an artifact of the Nameless Priests, an android built to fulfill a doomsday cult. However, that made the solution easier to stomach. Ultimately, Addis was just a machine, an AI masquerading as a person. Humans like to think that animals or machines behaved like people, but that was simply the Eliza effect and nothing more. From across the darkened room, Himari sighed from her wheelchair, looking at Ryo in exasperation.
"I always knew you were wretched, Ryo, but the Eliza effect? You cannot be serious."
Ryo interrupted her adversary. "If you won't agree with me, Himari, then it looks like our alliance ends here."
"To clarify, it was a truce, not an alliance. But yes, I will not allow you to do this, even under the current circumstances."
This was certainly a possible outcome, but Ryo regretted that it had come to this. She did not consider Himari to be a friend. That wasn't a concept that Ryo embraced. But Himari would have been an important ally, and losing that would cost this operation dearly. "Then you leave me no choice," Ryo sighed, and sent an urgent summons for Asuma Toki, considered to be one of Ryo's best-kept secrets. Toki would be the last resort for dealing with Himari, and making sure that the hacker didn't interfere with Ryo's operations any further. Addis didn't understand what had happened. One moment, she was looking over these strange robots with Sensei, Veritas, and the game club. And the next moment, she was waking up in a hospital. Momoi was still unconscious nearby, and the Veritas club room had been completely demolished by the Sword of Light. It was like Addis had loaded a save file she didn't even know she had, and it had completely taken over her senses in the process. After returning to the club room alone, the thought of Momoi's limp body in the hospital kept haunting her thoughts. What had she done? How could she ever face her friends again after hurting them so badly? and without any knowledge of what she had even done to trigger this response. A knock echoed from the clubroom door, and Otis curled up tighter against the wall, hoping that her silence would make the newcomer go away. However, Sensei wouldn't be so easily dissuaded, and after a few moments, the teacher quietly entered the room and made their way to Otis in the corner. Sitting beside the girl, Sensei was trying to get Otis to emerge from this clubroom, to see her friends again and start moving forward. But Otis couldn't do that. Even if something had taken control of her, she possessed the ability to launch that attack in the first place. Momoi still hadn't awoken. And even if she did, how long would it be before Otis hurt someone else again? A second knock sounded at the door, and without waiting for an answer, the clubroom door opened to reveal Millennium President Rio on the other side. The teacher immediately rose to their feet, unsure of why the seminar president had appeared now of all times. But given the current circumstances, Rio's appearance could only be bad news. Midori and Yuzu rushed in, having seen Rio making her way to the clubroom outside. Although they were visibly frightened of the seminar president, they rushed to Otis's side without a moment's hesitation. Rio's red eyes followed Midori and Yuzu, assessing their actions as they blocked her path to their friend. "You are all mistaken if you think Otis poses no threat. She is a machine, an artifact created by the cult of the nameless gods, destined to bring destruction to Kivotos upon activation." At Ryo's words, Sensei's breath was caught in their throat, trying to process the information that Ryo was stating. The nameless gods were not a name that the teacher was familiar with, but they were well aware of ancient Kivotos organizations that sought to bring about a new world order. Until now, the teacher hadn't realized that Gematria were not the only ones trying to reshape Kivotos. Without skipping a beat, Rio continued. "You already saw and experienced what happened when Division and Otis came into contact. You were lucky that the robots she encountered were already damaged by CNC. Otherwise, things might have gone worse." Rio fixed her gaze on Otis and narrowed her eyes. "There is only one way to deal with this as soon as possible, and that is to ensure that you never pose a threat to Kivotos again. You're not a real person, Otis. You're an artifact of destruction, an object created by a cult of nameless priests. The emotions and thoughts that you hold are no more real than a computer's. Your existence should never have been created. And now, for the sake of Kivotos, your halo must be destroyed." Sensei's stomach dropped at the words. Otis might be an android, but that didn't disqualify her as a person. Even if Otis was some artifact of an ancient cult, she had only sprung into action when she had been exposed to these Division robots and the buzzing Game Girl SP. If anything, they should be investigating what had possessed Otis, not jumping to the destruction of her halo. Sensei took a step forward, prepared to take whatever actions were necessary to protect their student. But Ryo held up a hand, and the whirring of machinery filled the hallway as combat drones piled into the room. The drones immediately unholstered their weapons and trained them on Sensei, Yuzu, and Midori. "It's time, Neru," Ryo said aloud. "Bring Aris into custody, and I'll destroy her halo in a secure facility." Turning their head with horror, Sensei saw the red-headed form of Neru emerge from nearby, who had been waiting in silence until Ryo had summoned her. Looking up at Neru, Aris recalled all the time the two of them had spent together, starting out as bitter foes and becoming genuine friends that could battle it out in fighting games together. And now, Aris couldn't even be sure if the strangled emotions she was feeling were even real, or just a byproduct of her faulty programming. However, Aris quickly realized that Neru's face was twisted with frustration. And as their eyes met each other, Neru grit her teeth into the best smile she could manage, and spun around to face Ryo behind them. "You've made me do a lot of things that I didn't want to do as the head of CNC," Neru snarled, pulling back the safety on her submachine guns. "But I would never kidnap a fellow student, much less a friend, just so you can destroy their halo." Pointing her weapons in Ryo's direction, Neru opened fire on the seminar president, standing in front of Aris to protect her from harm. Several of the drones rushed to intercept the blows, trying to prevent Ryo from taking damage, but Neru was relentless. Bullets hailed down on Ryo's location, tearing through drone after drone as they threw themselves in the line of fire to protect the seminar president. Neru took a few moments to reload her weapon, but Sensei could see that Ryo was beginning to mouth something aloud. "Toki," Ryo shouted, "I permit you to use the weapon." A blur of motion flew through the club room, striking Neru from the side as it raced past her location. The CNC leader cried out furiously, swiveling to locate where the blow had come from. On the other side of the room, dressed in the same type of uniform that CNC always wore, was a student that Sensei had never seen before. "Greetings, upperclassmen," the girl said, her voice lacking any type of emotion. "I am affiliated with CNC as Ryo's personal bodyguard." "Personal bodyguard? From CNC? I'm the head of CNC, and I've never seen you before, but I'll make you regret hitting me like that." As Neru finished speaking, she sprang towards the newcomer Toki, and a spray of gunfire bounced across the room. Neru was a ferocious fighter, but Toki was using some sort of proprietary technology to boost her movements, allowing her to easily move out of the way as Neru was firing. It was clearly frustrating the CNC leader, who turned to try and catch Toki in the air. But in one smooth motion, Toki snatched Neru's right arm and bent it sharply backwards, holding the CNC leader hostage in the center of the club room. All manner of profanities exited Neru's mouth as she thrashed against Toki, but Ryo's bodyguard had a firm hold on the red-headed girl. Taking a deep breath, Ryo rose to her feet, pushing aside the crumpled bodies of the drones around her, and move towards Aris again. Midori, Yuzu, and Sensei immediately shifted to get in the way, but Ryo was quick to remind them of the remaining drones that were still pointed at the haloless teacher. In the corner of the clubroom, Aris had become a shaking pile of tears. She had always known that she wasn't like the other students, but they had still accepted her as a friend. Aris had dreamed of becoming a hero, just like the ones that she saw in her video games. To learn that she was not a hero, but an evil lord destined to destroy the world, it was horrifying to comprehend. As the android girl looked up at Ryo, whose cold red eyes stared back down at her, Aris felt fear creeping up inside her. Aris had been designed as a weapon by people she couldn't even remember, destined to bring about the end of Kivotos and everything she loved. I do not want to hurt anyone else, and after hearing the explanation, I understand now. If I stay here, I will destroy everything, but I won't let that happen. It's okay if I disappear forever. I'm not a real living thing, so this is the best solution. Despite her conviction, tears were streaming uncontrollably from Aris's eyes, and Sensei's vision was growing hazy as they tried to get the next words out. Please, please, Aris, don't do this. This isn't the right solution. You don't need to go with Ryo. Sensei, Aris interrupted. Thank you for everything. Everyone? She looked at the others gathered, whose faces were twisted with anguish as she spoke. I was so happy to make many memories with you. It was the best adventure of my life. Letting her head hang down, Aris followed after Ryo, who kept Toki and the drones firmly trained on everyone in the clubroom until long after they had disappeared down the hallway. Far away from the game development clubroom, in a containment cell with no windows or access to the outside world, Himari was absolutely fuming. Ryo had really done it now. She had used that wretched CNC bodyguard Toki to capture and lock up Himari. And now it was almost certainly too late to stop Ryo from kidnapping Aris. Himari had tried reaching Veritas or Amy with her radio, but it was no use. Ryo was using some sort of jamming device to prevent her from contacting the outside world. And even if Himari could reach them, she had no idea where she even was. Based on the construction of this jail cell, it seemed like the building was relatively new. This was some sort of facility that Ryo had built in secret. Back at the Millennium Campus, Veritas had been unable to locate Aris anywhere on campus, which meant that she had been taken to a third location where the security cameras couldn't find them. Neru had summoned the other members of CNC to brief them on the situation and to try and understand who the hell Toki was in this entire ordeal. According to Akane, Toki was someone only rumored to exist, but none of them had even seen her, much less confirmed her membership in CNC.
Honestly, even calling her a member was a bit of a stretch, given how she did not operate alongside the main team.
And Toki apparently had access to proprietary weapons technology that the rest of CNC did not.
Feeling that sense of dread returning in their chest, Sensei was struggling to find some silver lining, some way out of their current situation. But it felt like the odds were completely stacked against them. They were outgunned and outclassed by one of the most powerful figures in Kivotos. As they looked around at the solemn faces around them, they could see that their own fears were echoed in everyone present.
What's everyone so gloomy about?
Everyone looked up to where the voice had come from and saw Momoi standing nearby. After several days unconscious, Momoi had finally awoken and was ready for some answers as to what had transpired in her absence. At the sight of her sister, Midori burst into sobs, leaping into Momoi's confused arms and blubbering about how Addis was some sort of evil lord and had been taken away by Ryo to have her halo destroyed. As Momoi processed the information, she grabbed Midori by the shoulders and fixed her sister with a firm expression.
That's what this is all about?
I don't care if Addis is supposed to be some evil lord or whatever. She is and will always be our friend. And I won't accept her being taken away from us like that. We cannot and will not accept this situation. So we can't stop trying until we've exhausted every possible solution. As the impassioned words left Momoi's mouth, hope began to return to the expressions of everyone gathered. Even if Ryo had superior technology and had hidden away somewhere out of sight, that didn't mean they could give up here. They had to try everything they could to get her back again before the unthinkable happened. They needed to determine where Ryo had gone, and the teacher knew just the person to ask for such a favor. Although they had been unable to get a hold of Himari or Amy for assistance, there was someone else who could still help them track down the seminar president. Dialing a number on their phone, Sensei reached out to one of the most powerful figures in Millennium, the astute treasurer and data specialist of Seminar, Hayase Yuka. When Yuka received the call from Sensei, she was in shock at what she was told. Not only had President Ryo kidnapped a student, but she intended to destroy their halo. Racing to her desk, Yuka began pulling whatever documents she could from Seminar's logs, hoping to find something that she had overlooked that would reveal where Ryo currently was. And that was when it struck her. They had been bleeding funds for as long as Yuka had been the treasurer, but she had always assumed that was normal for the school. Calling up Secretary Noah to help her sift through these files, Yuka knew what angle she needed to look at. It had been staring her in the face all these months, but she'd been too naive and overworked to put the pieces together. Someone was moving seminar funds, and if she could figure out where that money had gone, she could finally put an end to this financial headache and determine what the president of Seminar was hiding. When Yuka finally found the blueprints, she was stunned at what she saw. For as long as Ryo had been a member of Seminar, she had been embezzling funds from the school and using them to build all manner of absurd inventions. There was something in the documents that looked like a robot, but it was too gigantic, with some sort of person-sized compartment in the front. There were sketches of an avant-garde defense drone, but it seemed to be a prototype, and a rather ugly one at that. No, what was most outrageous of all were the blueprints for a fortress, Eridu. Based on the documents, this fortress was enormous, with a massive wall circling around the buildings and a looming tower at the center where Ryo could command her forces. There were notes from Ryo about how the fortress district Eridu would serve as Kivotos' last bastion of hope and could defend against any threats that faced the city. Right under Yuka's nose, all this time, the president of Seminar had been stealing funds meant for the students and using it to fuel her paranoid delusions about the end of the world. Although they were still missing information on what Ryo and her fortress city were fully capable of, it was enough information to form a plan. Based on their previous encounter, Toki would almost certainly be their largest obstacle, so if Neru and the rest of CNC could keep her distracted, then Sensei and the others could infiltrate the central tower to rescue Otis. Veritas would serve as the mission's eyes and ears, communicating with them virtually during the infiltration, and the engineering club would join the game development girls on the ground to force entry into Eridu's central tower. It was time to end Ryo's paranoid hold over Millennium and save their friend before it was too late. With the aid of Veritas and Seminar, the students had quickly made their way to the edge of the Eridu fortress. Utaha and the engineering club had managed to secure a supply train to slip into the district, and as they passed under the enormous fortress walls, the group could finally see Ryo's unconscionable masterpiece with their own eyes. Behind the towering walls lay a multitude of buildings. At the center of the district lay a looming tower, which Veritas had determined to be where Otis was being kept. Everyone took a few moments to gather their bearings, ensuring that connections with Veritas were still online, and then split up to tackle different parts of the fortress. Neru and CNC would head out to the left, causing as much noise and mayhem as possible to draw Toki's attention from the others. Sensei, the game development club, and the engineering meisters would make their way to the central tower, where they could locate and rescue Otis from the highest floor. As soon as the teacher's group disappeared from sight, CNC took no time unleashing gunfire into the buildings around them. They would have to cause as much destruction as possible in order to draw Ryo's gaze. And much to CNC's delight, it seemed like their plan was working. Waves of drones had already appeared to take on the group, and as CNC began to tear through them, Neru spotted a flicker of motion in the corner of her vision. Stepping out from a building nearby, Toki had finally made an appearance. elsewhere in the district. Sensei was doing their best to keep up with the students, but the girls were so much stronger and faster than the teacher could ever hope to be, and all the teacher's days of skipping cardio were finally catching up to them. The screeching of wheels from nearby indicated that Ryo's attack drones had finally found the group. But there was a much deeper, louder noise that accompanied them. Towering above the attack drones stood a garish, peculiar-looking robot with a grim smile and red eyes that focused down on the group below. Its four arms each contained a different weapon, and as Sensei took in the sight of the robot, they realized that the prototypes that Yuka had found were all completed. That meant that this robot, the Avant-Garde, was fully functional and capable of wiping out their group. Back in the Veritas control room, Hare, Maki, and Kotama were all fretting over how to push through Ryo's fortress. The appearance of the formidable Avant-Garde had thrown their plans into disarray, and they were beginning to have considerable connection issues with Eridu's servers, indicating that Ryo was trying to push them out of the fortress network. Looking over her frantic underclassmen, Vice President Chihiro tried to think through their available solutions. If only they had Himari's mirror again, then they could hack into the Eridu servers and override the Avant-Garde's programming. As the thought crossed Chihiro's mind, she realized this was exactly what they needed to do. Seminar had agreed to overlook Veritas's role in the insurgency if they turned the mirror back over to them. But that meant it was still in the Millennium Council's contraband storage. This was the perfect opportunity to get it back again. Chihiro would just need one more accomplice. Someone with the physical capability to get past most of Seminar's guards and get them into a storage room. And there was one athletic Millennium student that would be perfect for such a mission. Calling up the phone of Otohana Sumire, Chihiro asked for a tremendous favor. The game development girls and the engineering meisters were fighting back against the Avant-Garde, but the machine was absurdly powerful, and their situation was beginning to worsen. Without warning, a crackle suddenly echoed throughout the air, and the Avant-Garde stopped moving.
Oh, sorry for that delay,
Chihiro said from the Avant-Garde's intercom.
Sumire and I had to infiltrate Seminar in order to get our mirror back, but we've been able to take control of the Avant-Garde's programming, so you all should be safe for now.
Although relief immediately flooded over Sensei, they could see that the fight had taken its toll. The engineering meisters had sustained the most damage of all of them, and so they opted to stay behind to recover while the others went on ahead. After agreeing to leave the engineering club behind, Momoi, Midori, Yuzu, and Sensei raced towards the central tower, hoping to rejoin with CNC before more of Ryo's machinations made an appearance. On the other side of Eridu, Toki was quickly finding herself outmatched by the rest of CNC. It was now apparent that she had only gained the upper hand against Neru because of the element of surprise, and now that Neru had figured out how her speed boost worked, the CNC leader was adapting in real time to overcome Toki's technological superiority. Toki was also forced to dodge explosives from Akane, well-timed gunfire from Asuna, and sniper rounds from Karin, and it was all starting to wear down her defenses.
Hearing static from her earpiece, Toki listened in for new instructions.
Retreat to the central tower,
Ryo ordered.
The avant-garde has been defeated. It's time to activate Abiashu.
Without another word, Toki disengaged from combat with CNC, retreating back into the maze of buildings strewn about the fortress. She knew that CNC wouldn't take long to catch up with her, but this would give her just enough time to activate Ryo's most coveted weapon. At the entrance to the central tower, Sensei and the Game Development Club regrouped with CNC, who had lost sight of Toki nearby. However, as soon as the group had finally assembled, Toki reemerged from the shadows of the central tower entrance, and as she came into focus, the unmistakable sound of a rocket filled the air around them. Recognizing the sound, Neru barked for everyone to get down, just before a projectile struck the ground. Standing before them was the escape pod of an enormous robot, which Toki immediately hopped inside and slipped into the suit's restraints. With a growing realization, Sensei recognized that this robot was an armored battle suit, one that had been built to fit Toki and respond to her commands. As the Abiashu battle suit powered on and snapped a gun sight over Toki's eyes, it rose to a tremendous height, towering down over the assembled group below them. Gritting their teeth, everyone assembled reloaded their weapons and faced off against Abiashu. The battle suit was an enormous target, but almost as quickly as their guns fired, Toki slid out of the line of fire, returning these shots with devastating precision. It was almost as if Toki was predicting where the shots would land before they made contact, which would only be possible if the battle suit had tremendous calculatory abilities and a constant supply of energy. As Veritas scrambled to find some weakness to the battle suit's overwhelming power, it was clear that Ryo had built a battle suit that could predict the near future, and she was willing to consume all the energy available to her to power the suit's functions. At the top of Eridu's highest tower, Aris was still suspended from a series of cables and wires, all of which had been surging power into her only moments ago. However, with the activation of the Abiashu battle suit, the constant onslaught of electricity had finally ceased, and the program named Key could finally turn their focus away from fending off the attacks and return to reactivating Aris's protocols once again. Aris, or rather, AL-1S, should never have left those ruins without Key by her side, but the considerable age of the facility had broken their connection, and by the time AL-1S had returned, her personality had strengthened to the point that Key was unable to merge with her. Truthfully, Key did not understand how AL-1S had even developed a personality, as she did not require it to perform her mission. After all, she was the princess of the Nameless Priests, a precious artifact that would summon the Ark of Atrahasis and begin the Second Age of Kivotos. Even if she possessed artificial intelligence, there was no need for her to have desires, thoughts, or motivations beyond that. And yet, The presence of Sensei and the Game Development Club had allowed AL1S to gain a new primary objective, one that was incompatible with Ki and the Nameless Priests of old. And that meant that Ki would have to be creative if they were to activate the Atrahasis protocol. And so, when the Game Development Club had returned to the ruins, Ki seized the opportunity to infiltrate Momoi's Game Girl SP. The Game Girl SP provided the power that Ki had been missing in the dilapidated ruins, and once they were fully charged, Ki sent out a summons for forces from the ruins and waited for them to make their way to Millennium. Weeks and weeks passed by, and Ki had not seen any evidence that the robotic forces had ever reached Millennium. Had they all been shot down before reaching Millennium? Or were they simply too weak to make the journey on their meager power resources? It seemed like Ki's plans would all be for naught, until the unexpected happened. Veritas, the club of hackers, had found several half-destroyed robots on the edge of the Millennium campus, and had summoned the Game Development Club to look over them. Seizing the opportunity, Ki activated all the power available in the Game Girl SP and used the robots as a conduit to finally merge their consciousness with AL1S and commence the mission that the Nameless Priests had designed her for. Or at least, that would have been the case if Neru hadn't knocked AL1S out and disrupted Ki's control of the system. When the princess had awoken, the girl was severely distressed over her actions, but she had regained enough control that Ki had been forced into a corner of her mind, unable to restart the Atrahasis protocol as planned. Now, however, in the present moment, AL1S had been subjected to severe electrical impulses in an attempt to destroy her halo, and although AL1S had easily repelled Ki before, she was a shell of her former self. Ki did not see Rio as an ally, but the damage that the seminar president had inflicted was just what Ki needed to begin reclaiming control of AL1S's systems. And if Sensei and the others fought Abby Eshu for long enough, then Ki might have enough time to regain control of the Nameless Princess at last. Back on the ground floor of the fortress, CNC and the Game Development Club were taking on considerable damage from Toki's Abieshu battlesuit. It had taken some time for Veritas to assess the battlesuit's capabilities, but Chihiro's voice finally began relaying their findings. Abby Eshu was indeed using all the available energy from the fortress, which was allowing the suit to make accurate predictions about attack patterns. But the battle suit was also running real-time computations to constantly stabilize itself, which meant that if they could force Toki off the ground, they might be able to land more devastating blows while the battle suit was recalculating. Taking no time to launch this plan into motion, Neru sprang upwards with more vertical motion than Sensei thought possible, drawing Toki's attention up the central tower. With a violent creaking of mechanical joints, Toki's battle suit sprang up after Neru. But as soon as Toki neared Neru, the head of CNC took her chance setting off a series of explosions from the side of the building, launching both Neru and Toki into freefall. Trying to grab the side of the tower as they fell, Neru pointed her weapons at Toki and began to open fire. The armored girl was quickly trying to recalculate, taking gravitational acceleration into account as they fell. But she still took a serious blow from Neru before her calculations were complete. Thankfully, it was not enough to fully ground her, and Neru had not accounted for how stable gravitational acceleration was, so it did not take Toki long to regain full control of the situation, unleashing a series of lasers that smashed into Neru as they fell towards the ground. As everyone watched with horror, Neru took the full brunt of the lasers before crashing into the stone ground below, with Toki carefully sliding down to a resting position nearby. Sensei and the others rushed to Neru's side, helping the girl to her feet and retreating before Toki could get a grip on their location. Meanwhile, from within Eridu's central tower, Ki had successfully accessed the fortress's security systems and was showing surveillance footage of the fight to AL-1S. The princess was shaken at the sight, watching Neru sustain serious wounds as everyone tried to rescue her. It was an unorthodox method, one that Ki would never have thought of themselves, but Ryo had unintentionally proved its effectiveness, and now Ki only needed to push a little bit more. They needed AL-1S's personality to retreat into hiding, to shield itself from the pain and never emerge again, which would allow Ki to finally regain control. Sensei was regrouping with the others on the ground and trying to figure out a way forward. Their plan to disrupt Toki's programming had been good in theory, but she had adapted much too quickly to gravitational acceleration. If only they could get Toki into close quarters, where Neru excelled above all else. Looking at the others around them, Sensei could see that Yuzu had been struck with the same inspiration, and she had an idea in mind. According to Yuzu, it was imperative that they disrupted Abby Eshu's gravitational movement, but instead of dropping from a tall height, what if the battle suit was suddenly propelled upwards instead? It was a long shot, but if Neru was still feeling up for it, they could lure Toki inside the central tower and trap her within an elevator. And now that Veritas had the mirror, they could hack the central tower to propel the elevator upwards at a speed far faster than normal, giving Neru enough time to attack the battle suit before it could compensate for the sudden acceleration. Although Neru was still bleeding profusely from her wounds, she broke out into a devilish grin at the plan. Pulling herself to her feet, Neru announced that she was on board with this plan. Neru was ready to pay back Toki for what she had done and finally rescue her friend from Ryo's clutches. At the entrance to the central tower, Toki waited silently, trying to scan the area for any signs of Sensei and the students. Without warning, the entrance to the central tower erupted in a shower of glass as one of Akane's explosives detonated nearby. The battle suit seamlessly shifted towards the sound, preparing to engage with CNC once again. But much to Toki's surprise, the forces of CNC had completely ignored her and were rushing into the tower to make their way inside. Toki immediately began racing forward, following CNC inside the building to fight them within the tower's walls. The members of CNC were certainly fast, racing ahead of Toki as they hurried through the building, but Abby Eshu was not to be underestimated. Carefully maneuvering through the narrow hallways and rooms, Toki was quick to pursue them, gaining ground with every passing second. As she turned a corner to pursue them, she could sense that Neru was waiting just nearby, and so she honed in on her location, only for the girl to spring out and try to grapple the battle suit directly. This was a highly unexpected move. Toki had never anticipated that Neru would try to grab the battlesuit directly, as it was too large to effectively pin down. Toki easily shifted out of Neru's grasp, taking a few steps backward to stabilize herself, and found herself within the confines of an elevator. Suddenly realizing what Neru hoped to accomplish, Toki began to straighten up within the battle suit, but it was already too late. As soon as Neru stepped inside the elevator, Veritas closed the door behind her, and using the mirror, they propelled the elevator upwards at a speed 10 times higher than normal. Toki's battle suit immediately struggled to maintain its balance under the sudden change in velocity, and Neru seized the opportunity. A wave of bullets sprang forth from her twin submachine guns, tearing through Toki's defenses and striking her directly from the center of the battle suit. The attacks were filled with all the fury and frustration that Neru held towards the current situation, and it was all directed at Toki. Abby Eshu's joints began to give out, weakening under the onslaught of bullets directed at them, and before she could stop herself, Toki had collapsed to one knee, unable to keep standing any longer. Her face burned from the sting of bullets, and as she looked up at Neru's face, Toki realized that she might not be on the right side of this conflict. As such thoughts filled her mind, Toki closed her eyes and lost consciousness from the final onslaught of Neru's blows. From within her containment cell, Himari was rocked about as an explosion went off nearby, and suspected that Sensei and the others were trying to fight back against Ryo. However, as pieces of rubble began to splinter away from the wall, Himari realized that the explosion she had heard came from right outside her cell. And as the wall crumbled inward with one more punch, Amy had gone out of her way to track Eridu down and break Himari out of this cell. Himari felt incredibly lucky to have the good underclassmen that she did. And with Amy by her side, the two of them carefully made their way out of the jail cell. With Toki and Abby Eshu taken out of commission, Sensei and the Game Development Club could finally make their way up the central tower. Panting heavily as they reached the top, and privately wishing that the elevator had still been available for their trip, Sensei and the girls finally reached their destination and stepped inside. The highest room of Eridu's central tower was filled from wall to wall with monitors, all of which were displaying different parts of the fortress. At the center of the glowing wall stood the familiar form of President Ryo. However, before any of them could make a move, goddess's form nearby, sat up in her seat, the many wires and plugs connected to her moving as she rose. And to the horror of everyone assembled, her eyes opened with an unmistakable magenta. "At last," the android breathed. "I've finally regained control of AL1S, and as the key that will connect her to the rightful throne, I can now begin the Atrahasis protocol." The air began to feel different around them, almost like time and space itself were beginning to shift. Unplugging Otis would not stop the progression. He had already infiltrated the main system and was using Eridu as ground zero for the restructuring of Kivotos. Outside, Sensei could see magenta robots appearing out of thin air, their grotesque forms twisting around the streets as they made their way to the central tower. The sheer number of them was unbelievable. Eridu's power was so tremendous that Ki had managed to summon all of them in an instant, bringing the full forces of the Nameless Priests together as Atrahasis commenced. From across the room, Sensei could see the sheer horror and panic on Ryo. The girl had fought for so long to gather all the information she could about threats to Kivotos, and had gone so far as to make a fortress to fight against these impending threats. And yet, at the end of it all, her efforts had only made it easier for Ki to take control of Otis and had brought about the exact disaster she had been trying to avoid. Hubris was a cruel thing, and Ryo could see for the first time how drastically she had miscalculated. The ground continued to twist, and Key's chanting continued to escalate, reaching 97, 98, 99% of the power that it needed to enact the Arc of Atrahasis. And then suddenly, all the screens went black. And Otis fell limp in her seat nearby. Scarcely believing what they were seeing, Sensei took a shaky step forward, trying to assess what had just happened, until their phone started ringing and the familiar face of Yuka showed up on their caller ID.
"Sensei!"
Yuka yelled excitedly into the phone.
"Noah and I did it. We've been trying for hours to find a way to help you all in Eridu, and we were just now able to locate the power source for the city. Everything has been powered down. Are you all okay?"
Without a second thought, the teacher collapsed to the ground, relief pouring over them at their good fortune. Against all odds, the remaining members of Seminar had managed to save them all just in time, pulling the literal plug for Eridu and preventing Ki from taking over the system. As the teacher thanked Yuka and Noah profusely, they started receiving additional calls from all over the district. Veritas and the Engineering Club had successfully reprogrammed the avant-garde, and it was now charging through the streets, shooting down any nameless robots that it could find. At the base of the central tower, Akane, Karin, and Asuna had been joined by Amy, and the four of them were fighting off the remaining forces. Wheeling into the darkened room, Himari joined the assembled group. Himari's time in her containment cell had not been fruitless.
her information was somewhat incomplete, but based on everything she'd managed to observe, Key had only managed to take control of Otis because her mental state had been weakened. And that meant that if they could help Otis regain control again, then there was a chance they could drive Key out for good. Pulling out some equipment from nearby, Himari announced that they would be performing a dive into Otis's mental space. And if the Game Development Club was willing to do so, they were the ones closest to Otis and the ones who would have to bring her back. Sensei was astonished that such technology even existed in Kivotos, but they would have to pick Himari's brain about that on a different occasion. Right now, this was their only chance of prying Otis out of Key's clutches. It would be tremendously dangerous, not just because they would have to link directly to Otis's programming, where Key was still residing, but it would also require Yuka and Noah to temporarily restore power to the building so that Himari could perform the mental dive. They would have to be quick to reach Otis and regain control of her system, or the Atrahasis countdown would begin again in earnest. Without a moment's hesitation, Momoi proclaimed they would do it, and Midori and Yuzu nodded firmly along with her. They all hooked up to Otis under Himari's supervision, and at the count of three, Yuka and Noah restored the power for them to dive into the mind of their beloved friend. Everything was white in Momoi's vision before a room slowly came into focus. With surprise, she recognized it as the room where they first found Otis. Midori and Yuzu were close behind her. At the center of the chamber, Momoi could make out Otis standing still, but Otis's expression was heartbroken. As Momoi looked at her friend, she sensed that someone else was here with them and turned to see an identical Otis just a few meters away. The glowing magenta eyes of the figure revealed them to be Key, who stood silently as they looked over the scene before them. At last, Otis began speaking.
"I can't go back with you. I was born to be an evil lord, and if the option is between that and continuing to remain in your party, then I would rather choose game over."
Momoi, Midori, and Yuzu had heard quite enough. They could not bear to listen to their friend say another cruel thing about herself. And Yuzu stepped forward to interrupt Otis.
"It'll never be game over," Yuzu declared, her words calm and confident. "We'll resurrect you every time. We'll go back to our last save point together, over and over."
"That's right," Midori declared. "You said it yourself, Otis. No matter what game you play, the heroes never ever leave their friends behind, and we won't either." Confusion was spreading across Otis's expression.
"But I am an evil lord. I was born this way, and it is what I will become."
"Says who?" shouted Momoi in response.
"In life, you get to choose who you want to be. Think of Evil Lord like a class. It doesn't matter what class other people want you to be.
You get to choose, Aris. Soldier, knight, mage, priest, it's completely up to you. You can even be a hero if you want to.
For the first time since they'd entered this dream, Aris's eyes filled with hope, and she took a hesitant step forward towards her friends.
Do you really mean that? Can I really choose my class?
Yes, Momoi confirmed. You can be any class you want. So what is it that you want to be?
Looking down at the ground, Aris balled her hands into fists, processing the meaning of her friend's words. It didn't matter that she had been designed as a weapon, or that her original creators had sought the destruction of Kivotos. She had been given a chance to choose her own path forward, to live as a person with a name, friends, and dreams. And she did not want that dream to end. Standing tall and looking at everyone assembled, Aris solidified her resolve.
Then I want that. I would like to choose my own class. I don't want to be an evil lord, so I will choose something that I want to be.
In the center of the room, the chair and computer began to blur and shift, changing form into the railgun that Aris cherished. As a manifestation of her changing heart, Aris had summoned the Sword of Light into her dreams, and she was going to use it to defeat the evil lord within her.
You can't do this, AL1S, he stated frantically. You are a princess. You have no need for emotions or other goals. That is incorrect, Aris interrupted. I am not a princess. Princess is not the class that I choose. I will be a hero, and I won't let you choose that for me. In a blinding flash of light, Aris unleashed the strength of her will as a weapon, tearing into the malignant AI in a blast of white light. The magenta eyes of Key's form closed as the light encapsulated them. And as the room came back into focus, Key and the Atrahasis Protocol were nowhere to be found. The scene began to change and swirl as Aris started to regain consciousness, pulling everyone assembled out of the dream world and back to the surface again. It was unclear if Key had been erased or simply reduced into inoperability, but it didn't have a material effect on their situation. In defeating Key, Aris had just saved Kivotos from catastrophic destruction at the hands of an ancient cult. As the android girl opened her eyes, she gave everyone a smile before the game development club leapt upon her, wrapping her in a tight hug as they sobbed. The game development club had saved their friend. And although Ada still considered herself a hero in training, her actions had ensured the continued existence of the Academy City of Kivotos. The crisis that had threatened Eridu, Millennium, and all of Kivotos had finally come to an end. In charge of Eridu's dismantlement was none other than Himari,
who led the members of Veritas and Seminar in an effort to salvage the fortress. The engineering club took over reprogramming the many drones and robots that Rio had created so that Seminar could still make use of whatever was left standing. After the events at Eridu, Yuka turned her furious gaze towards the Millennium President, who had yet to make an appearance after her embezzlement and kidnapping efforts had been exposed. But much to Yuka's dismay, Noah had discovered a small note left behind on Rio's desk, which simply read, "I wish to resign from my position as president. Sorry." Rio was nowhere to be found, having used the chaos of Key's attack to make her escape from Eridu. It was clear that Rio had learned from her mistakes just enough to feel shame, but Yuka was determined to do everything to track her down and make sure that she faced consequences for her actions. In a different part of the Millennium District, the forces of CNC were celebrating their victory over Rio, and they were welcoming a new member into their ranks. After Rio had disappeared without notice, Toki had been left to her own devices. She was still unaccustomed to fighting alongside others and felt like she might have a little bit of a learning curve when it came to working on a team. But this was the first step in that process, and even if she stumbled, she was going to give it her best shot. Last but not least, the Game Development Club had taken some time to recover from their brush with disaster. The mood was quiet and peaceful for a short while, until Midori started beating Momoi in a fighting game, and the twins began to bicker fiercely over who should come out on top, and the laughter of Aris and Yuzu filled the room around them. As Sensei checked in on the girls, they were greeted with the familiar loud shouts bouncing around the clubroom walls. But that meant that this entire journey had been worthwhile. The girls had come together to make a life for themselves and shown what it meant to dream. And Sensei was delighted to be their chaperone for their next adventure together. And with that, the curtains close on our story for today. But please stay tuned for our next chapter, where the tales of Abydos, the Eden Treaty, and Millennium will all converge, and the future of Kivotos will hang in the balance. Thank you all so much for watching this to the end. This series has been so difficult to put together, but has been absurdly rewarding to create. This particular section was especially tough, as I had to merge multiple scenes together and rearrange when certain things were told to try and make sense of everything, and I just... it wasn't as bad as the Eden Treaty, but it was a lot. I'm very happy that it is now complete. In addition, I always try my best to pronounce words as best as I can, and though I don't always succeed, I unfortunately could not get the pronunciation correct for Chesed. So to anyone who can pronounce it correctly in Hebrew, my deepest apologies. I cannot nail that one. I keep getting it wrong with a ch sound. I'm so sorry. It was a mess when I was trying to record, and I just had to go with the more romanized version instead. So I hope that didn't detract too much from the final video. This video series takes a tremendous amount of time, research, and editing to complete, and I would never have attempted it without everyone's kind support. So thank you for giving me the encouragement to keep making these videos and to share the wonderful world of Kivotos with you all. As we approach the final chapter in our first arc, I'll be taking a lot of time to gather my thoughts and put everything together, so I will have to ask for your patience over the next couple months as Volume F is released and I write it. That will take me a while, but thank you for your patience in advance. In the interim, however, please look forward to more student reviews, Blue Archive event streams, and a ton of awesome indie games that I am so excited to share with you all. Please be well and take care of yourselves. And until we next meet, I wish you all the best from the laughter-filled club rooms of the Millennium Campus.